Super Bowl down here.
Yeah, fight. Oh, I got a fight, huh?
A little bit.
Yeah, it's going to be a little fight. I thought you were living in luxury all these years.
Nah, just looking like it.
Yeah.
You should know how that goes.
Man, we don't complain, huh?
When you say nigga, a lot of people are
saying nigga.
Why y'all do this?
Next to your favorite person.
Why the hell?
Next to your favorite person.
It's got to be something against this now.
Next to your favorite one. My computer.
Nah, I just can't pop out the headphones.
Because.
You lighting all set up for black as fucking this seat?
Yes. Black and ignorant. That was the lighting for that section over there.
No, you gotta push it in something. Balance it out a little bit.
Put me next to this nigga,
no,
man.
You had a rape person.
What did I do to deserve this again?
It shouldn't tip over anymore, yeah?
Yeah, I won't put my chair in the studio anywhere else but next to this nigga. And now that we back home, y'all putting me next to this nigga again?
That's right.
Yes.
What is the matter with you niggas, man?
You can't reach that far. That's too far.
You niggas are sick. You need help.
Why?
Because you keep sitting me next to this nigga, man.
It's the best thing that's ever happened.
I thought you wanted to have a productive show.
Better you than me, my nigga.
Can you reach two?
This ain't nice.
I ain't like, it's been a while since I got the chance to stare you niggas in the face while I pop. It's been a while.
Yeah.
It's been a while since I had to point at you niggas' faces. It's been a while.
Oh, yeah, because, yeah, we're
typically, I'll be sitting around tabled up.
Asante, black man.
Sacrifice, man.
Yeah.
It's yours right there. Mainly.
Yeah. I already have water. Mm-hmm. Alright, disclaimer. If my knees rub together, no homo.
No, it's fine.
I had water early.
Early.
Alright, pre-show. Did you see Rob Kardashian's text messages that leaked?
No.
Him and, what's his face? Light Skin China are going through like a custody battle. And he messaged her assistant calling her a nigger and a faggot. And they're trying to enter it into the legal proceedings so he could lose that baby.
It's a dirty game, bro.
Man, the Kardashians are all fucked up this week.
But Rob Kardashian says nigger, huh?
Is that a hint of surprise? I detected your voice.
A tad.
Oh, wait, he has a black girlfriend and black nieces and nephews and kids. Oh, no. He can't be a racist.
His dad helped free
OJ. I'm not saying he couldn't be a racist.
You said the chances were slim?
I just thought he was pussy.
Nothing about Rob is slim. All right.
I thought he was pussy. I thought he was too pussy to say nigga. My bad.
Nah, we done made it too easy for them to say nigga nowadays.
Fuck you, man.
We think that shit make him a part of the culture.
Yep. Invite him to the cookout.
Yeah.
So shit. Easy to get invited to the cookout.
Fuck the cookout.
I don't like the cookout.
It don't carry the same weight as it used to.
The food is killing y'all at the cookout.
Talk to him, black man.
Haitians don't even have cookouts. We have funerals. You're not invited to the funeral. That's the only time you see Haitians cooking
is that
togetherness.
You're not invited to the funeral.
All right, Bennifer, let's get to work. We've kept the people waiting long
now
enough.
You're listening to.
We brought that shit back this episode.
The millions.
And millions!
In fact, I got called a nigger so much, I didn't think there was anything wrong with it. I thought it was
shit,
my
I know
name.
I got virgin lungs. Y'all got a mask. Corona.
Ladies and gents, welcome back. The Niggas With Opinions.
Don't
podcast.
Smoke in that nigga face.
Go ahead,
right?
Sing that shit.
We some niggas with opinions.
Many lies.
We some niggas with opinions.
That's where y'all.
We some niggas with opinions.
Many lies.
We some niggas with opinions.
That's where
y'all. Nigga with a pin, 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 nigga with a pin. I know some niggas and they got opinions. Bitch, you need opinions, you should get in front of these niggas. Bitch, you need opinions, you should get in front of these niggas. Bitch, you need opinions, you should get in front of these niggas. Hey, me, Chris, Benny, and Ricky home. Hey, and you bitches can't get me home. You already know what we are. In the cut is our brother Hassan. Hey, trying to get right. All night we gonna fight those and we gonna burn you like McDonald's Sprite. NWO, ho, we ain't no regular Joe Blows, ho, on the podcast show, ho, letting these bombs go, ho. on the freestyle, they say he wild. Bitch is gonna be a while till I fall off with the salt off. And little mama gonna take them drawers off. Hey.
Look at Plus with the cue.
With the start. Hey, you're a natural, okay? I watched you go off of vibes and muscle memory. This nigga came in Plus, off nigga, of vibes.
This nigga leaned in and says, I can't hear
anything. Hey. You went off a vibe, sir. Okay.
Oh, man.
It's magnificent work, y'all. Magnificent. But ladies and gents, welcome back. This is the Niggas with Opinions, Circle R. Yes, we came that far. We're not Joe Rogan. We don't use the hard R.
Wow.
I'm Bennessy. Take a shot of me, and I'm joined by my brothers in buffoonery. Plus,
what's happening?
Ricky the Prince.
Yep.
The vegan trap lord.
Gay.
And we have one of the generals of this here nigga Navy. Brother Hassan back in the motherfucking building.
All right. Peace, black family.
Welcome back.
Yeah. Show title, Six Rings. It's the sixth time I've been up here. Six rings. Yeah.
Wait, is he in the lead as far as our guests go?
Oh, yeah.
Six rings.
Yeah, because six is up.
It's crazy because he always says that he's never been invited back to the most.
Never.
And here he is on our show. He's the most invited back.
Six.
Appreciate
nigga.
It. Oh, shit. I'm sorry. I don't even want to throw the show off. I brought gifts. I brought trinkets.
Oh, man.
BrotherHassan.com. Check it out. BrotherHassan.com.
BrotherHassan.com.
Revolutionary Buttons. Book, Haiti and her friends.
I'm
check it out.
I'm down to terrify niggas in the airport. Let's do it.
Yeah, blood trinkets, blood trinkets, blood gifts. Yeah.
Brothers, how are we doing? How we feeling?
Doing amazing, man.
Ben, how's your week going so far?
Good. I got the, my palms are itching right now, so I feel like I'm about to come into some money.
Niggas, February.
Tax
season. W-2's out, right?
Yeah.
It's coming. But then again, niggas like you don't make money during tax season. Who are we kidding? Richard, how are you?
I'm good. This weekend, I just drank a lot, that's all.
Yeah? How are you recovering? I know you're getting up there in age.
Man, it takes so long to recover now. It takes a long time to recover.
Christopher, how are you?
I'm good, man.
Yeah? Living life?
Going through life.
Wearing shades on the inside? Cooler?
Yeah. Him and Ben. I'm in these 2K streets with these niggas now.
Ricky has finally joined the PS5 gang. He is now with us. He plays with us, Paws, online.
Yeah.
Look at his face. Fucking pause police. Take it easy, bro.
While we have Hassan here, I do not know. We're not gonna do
how
that.
Else could you say he plays with us without how else could
he
you
be
say
on the game?
I mean, I guess. That's another way. You wanna
that's
play
the way. It's not the other way, it's the way.
It's a way. You know, it's a way. Hermano Hassan, how are you doing?
I can't complain, man. Fighting white supremacy, trying to educate the African race, elevate, all that.
Is it harder or easier than it used to be?
It's getting a little harder. It's getting a little harder.
Because one would say it should be easier with the amount of quote-unquote wokeness being spread around. What makes it harder?
A lot of disinformation. Mm. A lot of people spreading bullshit, you know. So that makes it a lot harder, you know. We got a lot of people now saying we Native American, you know, the Israelites,
I
the
saw
aliens.
That. The problem is,
I've seen the Israelites.
All of that shit is crazy enough to kind of make sense. Yeah. Like, when they tell you we never found any slave ships and we could be Native Americans, all right, okay. I mean, what am I going to do? Google some shit that's going to disprove it?
I mean, with that theory, you know, if you say that we didn't come from Africa, right? Not saying you personally, but if you didn't come from Africa, how the crackers got here then? I mean, the Europeans had to show up somehow on some ships. Where they ships at? I mean, some things, you know, disappear
marvelous
after
point.
Time.
Yeah, yeah. Marvelous yeah. point.
That's true. You know?
They didn't surf here.
Yeah. So, true.
I mean, you know, they're all white.
Critical thinking.
Yeah,
you know?
Right. Okay.
So it's making it a little harder, man, with all these different ideologies. And you know,
so the same argument you have for us, you can have for them. Like,
Yeah, 100%.
That's true. All right.
What are those fucking boats?
Let's get into some bullshit here. Has everybody even kept abreast of the bullshit going on with Kanye and Kimberly?
I just know that I just learned this week that their divorce shit is real. I thought it was like a rollout. I thought it was like
all right. So
publicity.
Crash course, right? They got divorced.
Mm.
Pretty serious. Well, getting divorced. Okay. She moved on, started dating. He followed suit and started doing the same after his cries to get his family put back together didn't work.
When it
right?
Ran.
The entire time they've been married, he's had an issue about his children on social media. But I guess, you know, when you're with your wife, it's just some shit you got to eat.
Yeah.
I guess because now that they're apart, he's ramping up on that shit.
Yeah.
Northwest and Kim have a mother-daughter TikTok. He doesn't want that shit at all. There's been shit happening, like the kids having a birthday party, him not having the information. He moved across the street from the kids, and people are trying to paint him as if he's stalkerish as opposed to being a dedicated father. So he's frustrated with how he's coming across in the media, but Kim is saying the proof is in the motherfucking pudding. Everybody's seeing how erratic he's acting. And the thing is, erratic can be painted. You know what I mean? Like, we've seen them paint plenty of nigga as erratic before with just a few posts online.
Yeah.
So it's like, I've been looking at it back because this shit has been, I've been captivated by it, honestly. Because it's, because typically it's easy to call Kanye a jackass, but from what I can see in the information that I have, it looks like he's trying to be a dedicated father.
Yeah, but he's a black man. Why would they paint it that way?
Why would they paint it that way and they don't know what that looks like?
And of course they're making Kim Kardashian out to be the victim in this all of this, right?
But the thing is, because she has, unfortunately, she has a team, a PR team.
Because I know he did say on Drink Champs that he hates her publicist.
But
she,
like,
puts out a lot of bullshit.
You should see some of the statements they put out in response to Kanye shit.
I know.
Everything they say makes him look fucking loopy. And he's not going to help.
Yeah,
because he's going to say it. If it's on his chest, it's on the internet.
Yeah.
Right.
You know what I mean? Yeah. So it's not like he's an easy nigga to defend. I guess as a father, all I can do is just feel bad for him.
Mm. Yeah.
One of the funnier moments to me, in my opinion, throughout this entire divorce and parenting conflict that they have is Candace Owens came to this nigga's defense. And people was agreeing with Candace. Like,
that's not just crazy. Candace,
yeah,
also WAC 100.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm nervous as fuck when I'm on the same side as Candace and WAC 100. They never have good takes.
That wasn't on my 2022 bingo.
They're also saying, like they're saying that this is what it looks like when a man is being dedicated to his children, mm-hmm, and nobody recognizes what it looks like. We all know how manipulative that family can be.
Yeah.
So don't believe everything you read. And it's true. I just wish it had come from you.
Yeah.
Right.
But are we really feeling sad for him, though? Like, on a racial tip, y'all know I'm always gonna bring around to the racial tip.
Talk about it.
Fuck with them white girls, them non-African women, right? You see what's gonna happen. Like,
the chickens coming home to roost. These are chickens coming home to roost.
They coming home to roost. They coming home to roost.
Buck bacaw, nigga. Cockle doodle doo, pal.
Coming home to roost.
This was crazy. Amber Rose has been gracious about it. But she spoke this into existence.
She did.
She was like, you're feeding into this shit and you're letting them gas you up, but those same motherfuckers you're hanging out with will be your undoing one day, and I hope I'm there to witness it. Mm. She was like, because when they were bringing the tweet back up, she was like, nah, I'm not that woman anymore. Yeah. I wish them well. But she still.
She was coming from a hurt place. She's right.
It was still prophetic.
It's still prophetic. But then again, also women were saying the same thing about Kim, where it's like, when you enable the behavior of bad men, eventually the gun gets turned on you. It's also what they were saying. Mm.
There was a clip that circulated on Twitter that her and Chloe were discussing how Kanye had asked her to get a Band-Aid for him one time, and he wanted a properly toned, a skin color Band-Aid. And she was like, how that's just too much work for her. And I was like, bruh, you're the wife of a billionaire. You mean to tell me getting a properly colored Band-Aid for the nigga is too much work? God, I can't imagine what your household life is like. If just getting the right color Band-Aid is a fucking, oh, come on. Just use the Band-Aids in a bathroom situation. If that's an issue, then please, fuck off.
And like, I don't know how to feel about that, because on one hand, sure, that could be a point. But also, bro, we're collectively worth $3 billion. There's 16 bitches working in this house right now. You going to ask me?
Wait. Collectively. When you say collectively.
She's worth about a billion, too.
Yeah.
I don't know who you're talking about here.
Under a billion. She ain't worth no billion.
Why not?
She's worth a billion.
Kim Kardashian?
I don't know where you've been.
Man.
First of all, she show me. If we're gonna keep it a buck here, show me. She carried that boy to the Billy.
Ah.
Okay, he was in the next when he got there.
Y'all really selling out like this in front of Hassan?
I'm just repeating what Kanye said.
I'm appalled.
I'm repeating the words that he said. He got with that bitch and he was negative. He's a Billy up.
Nah.
I don't know about that.
You got to give the black man credit.
I do want to take the time to point out that when you fuck around with them white hoes, you end up losing your sanity.
There you go.
Let's look at A.B.
Shit.
Brown. Let's look at Kanye.
Cuba Gooding Jr.
Like when you, because here's the reality. The farther you go up, the whiter it gets, right? And the whiter it gets, the more alienated you feel in your thinking and your person and who you are. And you start losing grip of reality. I don't agree with Snoop Dogg about a lot of shit. But when he was saying about Kanye, about he needs some black women around him to slap his ass, that's what he needed.
When Kanye goes home at night, where are the niggas? Think about it. When you go home, it's your mother-in-law, your kids, who are pretty much white.
And
then right?
When he talks, he doesn't even talk about niggas. Every name he mentions is some famous designer, white.
Yeah.
That's where
niggas.
He is.
Yeah, I know what I'm saying, but do you talk about where the niggas, what niggas he hang out with?
All this shit just looks concerning to me, though, because those video clips of their little like get-togethers and parties, they all look like they're on drugs, man. Are they drugging Kanye as well?
I don't know. I can't call
it. Get out, man. Get out. Did you not watch the movie? Get out, man.
And then there are constant cries, and he's alluding to it, how they keep trying to put him on medication.
Well.
And I don't know if he needs it, bro. Who knows? I don't know what his deal. I can't diagnose him.
Yeah.
I just know that shit looks crazy, but it also could be the Kardashian money machine.
I can diagnose him. He got crackatosis. You got to get him away from crackers.
How do you heal or treat crackatosis?
Get him away from them crackers.
And drink water, man.
You drink water. Decalcify the pineal gland. That's what he got.
Crackatosis, man. All
right, speaking of niggas around a bunch of white people saying crazy shit, anybody seen Sister Whoopi?
Oh Lord!
I've heard of it. She said, "She made a comment about the Holocaust." Right?
We have the clip, please.
She stay on some bullshit, bro.
I mean, like I said on the Patreon, bro, there's not a lot that Whoopi can do wrong to me. She was Sister Mary Clarence. She was goddamn.
You gotta stop.
She was goddamn silly.
A white man wrote that movie.
Which one? Color Purple?
Yeah. No, the other one.
Sister Act?
Hell yeah!
Yeah, sure. I'm sure. All right.
Stop giving her credit for shit white people did, man.
You know that shit. Refresh it. All right. So, anyway, she's been suspended for these comments for about 2 weeks, I believe.
Then let's be from truthful about show? It, because the Holocaust isn't about race. No, it's not about race.
It's about a different race.
But it's not about
that
race.
That zipping you heard.
It's not
was
about race.
What is it about?
Because
premium...
it's about man's inhumanity to man. That's what it's about.
But it's about white supremacy.
But these are two Roma. White groups of people.
Well, that how was do we after black
people
see
them as white people.
But you're, missing the, You're missing the point. The minute you turn it into race, it goes down this alley. Let's talk about it for what it is. It's how people treat each other. It's a problem. It doesn't matter if you're black or white, because black, white, Jews, everybody. Eats each other. So is it, if you're uncomfortable, if you hear about mouse, should you be worried? Should your child say, oh my God, I wonder if that's me? No, that's not what they're going to say. They're going to say, I don't want to be like that.
Well, hopefully. I want to be cool.
Yeah.
And
most kids, they don't want to be cool.
No, they don't.
And
we're living
sure
in a, you know, we're
you
living
mean
in an era
is?
Where yeah. people are.
Are you sure you don't mean?
Yo, y'all ain't got no tap dance music? See, that's what happened when you tapping too hard. That's when you tapping too hard. She's historically incorrect. It was all about race.
Yeah.
Most Jewish people have African ancestry, right? This is why this is why Hitler particularly attacked these non-Anglo-Saxon countries that had the Moorish blood in them. It was 100% about race.
100%. I don't know where
Hitler wanted to create a pure race.
His deal, yeah. Creating a pure race.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know. That's what happened when you tap dance too hard.
So, essentially, it was white supremacy versus whiter supremacy.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what it was. White on white crime.
Can whiter supremacy be
whiter supremacy is definitely a contender.
No, whiter supremacy. Whiter,
yeah.
The whitest supremacy of them all. Anybody see her coming back? Anybody see her getting this job back? Will this be a big deal? Or
she'll be back.
I don't feel like this is gonna kill her career at all. It's not, but they're definitely gonna make us think about it. Like, they've already like assigned the like certain representatives to represent the Jewish community, speak up about it. Ugh. Like, it's they're I making just, us think about it.
I'd be remiss if I didn't mention just how flippant niggas are about slavery, right? But mention the Holocaust, mention what they perceive to be anti-Semitism, and everything is shut the fuck down. That's all. Mm-hmm. That's all I have to say about that. Let's see here. Okay, well, once again.
Yeah, and I ain't even mad at it. We need to get on code like that. We need to have a monolithic way of viewing slavery, that's, man.
I mean, you know what it is? It's not even about, like, and I know once they're going to view this as racism, but, like, nobody jumps when the Jews say shit because you're afraid of them as a community. It's just that, like, the amount of capital and influence they have.
Yeah.
Like, they're going to bust that ass. So, like, until we can attain that kind of influence, that kind of capital, why not offend us?
Until we can organize it, because we have it.
Yeah, we have it. Hitting Joe Rogan across the head. Yeah. NDIRE hitting Joe Rogan across the head. So, I mean, we have it. It's just that we have so many people who would toe the line to say, well, I didn't find that offensive. Yeah. Or it's not about race or, you know, that whole nigga thing. We have the influence. We are the culture. You know what I'm saying? We are the influence. So
I really hate I'm black and I didn't find that racist ass nigga. Shut your ass up. Yeah, shut the fuck
that's
up.
That's the one. That's who fuck it up for everybody.
Shut the fuck up.
Yeah. We got to make a coon list. If you do this, you a coon. Like, yeah. Make a general list of the shit Terry that make Cruz. You a coon, man. And hold you to that shit. And once you label coon, we don't support you no more.
Yeah.
You gotta rename.
We should legit like generate a list like that.
Yeah, we should have that. People be off code like a motherfucker. Cool. Man.
Who can we nominate just off bat? Top three. Come top on, three.
Terry Crews. Candace Owens got it.
Terry Crews for MVP.
Has anybody seen MVC Herschel Walker's son?
Oh,
that motherfucker is a
that nigga is truly disgusting.
That's
he
crazy.
Truly is a disgusting human being.
He's disgusting, bro.
Like, he really is the fucking worst.
One, for one, he thinks he's a woman, and two, he thinks he's white.
Yeah, that's that mulatto
just so
problem.
Much screaming sass. I fucking hate it. I fucking
when
hate
white
it.
People see you, they see nigger. You know, like, I know you think you're not one, but that's what white people see. That's what they assume.
Your fucking daddy's white ass nose running through fucking O lineman for years, and now you think somehow. Okay, all right, guys. Joe Rogan, Ricky's podcasting brother. Has been caught saying one too many niggers.
Why is he my brother?
Hold on, Rick.
I don't know that fucking guy. Why the fuck is my brother?
The confusion that painted Ricky's face. My brother.
That fucking guy.
He's been caught saying one nigger too many. Not to come to his defense, right?
They all
said. But most of those niggers, like, well, the ones he were caught saying on camera, he was quoting somebody. He just thought he was too cool to say N-word.
Yeah.
Right.
Right? Do I believe that cracker in particular is racist? Probably not. Of all the crackers that I see, he's one of the more open-minded ones. But it's still like niggas wouldn't play that way about Jews and the Holocaust. That's all.
A statement about Planet of the Apes, though. Come on.
I didn't hear that one. What did he say?
He's like hanging around black people's like Planet of the Apes.
But Planet of the Apes, the movie is about being fish out of water. Right?
But when we talk about the correlation to calling black people apes and monkeys.
No, I hear what you're saying. Like, but the theme of the movie is literally like a human being surrounded by, I guess, apes.
Yeah.
That's apes. The fucking problem.
Sure apes.
I'm trying to see how you're trying to spin this.
The movie wasn't literally about monkeys.
Yes.
No, I mean, okay, it's literally about monkeys. Yeah. Right. But it was symbolism for being a fish out of water.
He had no, well, he wasn't trying to be symbolistic.
No, he wasn't.
He was what it was for him.
But it's a deeper symbolism to that, though. It's a big deeper symbolism.
You know what
though.
Symbolism? A fish out of water. If I wanted you to get the symbol of a fish out of water,
you're planning
on
a fish?
No, you know what I would have said? I would have said, man, hanging around black people is like being a fish out of water.
Right.
That's what the fuck he should have said.
Planet of the
Minded
fish
his white business.
A planet
is what
full
he should have done.
Planet for the fish.
Hey, but guys, no, he has a black girl though.
We talked about how they fetishize.
Facts. People don't know that, man. Like when slavery ended, there was 10 million mixed race people out of the slave population. Like, think about those numbers. How many women were being raped at that time period? Like, these crackers could 100% lay down with you and still wake up and uphold white supremacy. Excuse me, my numbers are off. 5 million out of the 10 million. Excuse me. So that's half of the population with mixed race coming out of slavery.
And that's they always say that, oh, I have a black friend. That's how you know a motherfucker's racist.
Yeah.
I have a black friend. I love black people. I love the blacks. I have a black friend. One of my friends is a black.
Your black friend hates you.
Well, my friend is a black.
Low-key hates you.
What have you done for that black friend?
They don't got me as a black friend. If you ever hear a cracker say they got Brother Hassan's a black friend, then there you go. But the friends they got is coons.
Speaking of which, did anybody catch wind of the New York mayor?
Oh, he's the one that made that comment about, was it New York?
So he was talking about the police while he was on his campaign trail. Crackers, yeah. And he referred to them as them crackers.
I guarantee. Is he fired yet?
No, he's on an apology tour. But the shit is so funny because the way he said them crackers, it wasn't a one-time thing. This is, he continuously says crackers in his everyday life, and they caught him on camera.
That's a part of his vocabulary. We have to
tape it. And bro, it is. Hold on, I'm about to play the tape.
Can I hear it?
Oh my gosh.
This was back in 2019. The video is getting a lot of attention this afternoon.
Every day in the police department, I kick those crackers.
Those comments made during a private event held by the Harlem Business Alliance. At the time, he was just gearing up to campaign for mayor. The activist who shot the video, says Adams, was talking about how he would, quote,
right the wrong. Is in New York.
Yeah.
You know, like, they're
and they're racist as fuck.
The NYPD is the most biggest,
crooked,
most racist gang in New York.
LAPD, but yeah. LAPD and NYPD are probably the worst departments.
So it's like, to hear your mayor calling you them crackers. And this is the thing. Dade County niggas know. When I call you them crackers, it's not about race.
It's not about race.
Right. It's about being an authority figure. Right? So Chinese cop, Puerto Rican cop, you are them crackers. That's how it happens.
Black cop. You are black cop.
The moment you put the badge on, you are a cracker.
Right.
It was just so funny because you never hear niggas at this level nigging. You know what I mean? Like, it's rare to catch up nigga. Yeah, it's glimpses. But this right here, man, he was playing to his crowd.
I remember how profound it was to me when I found out what cracker really was from. I thought, it was, you know, growing up, I was like the little white saltine crackers. But it was called that because the whip was cracking.
Yeah.
When I finally learned that shit, I was like, oh, shit. My mind was blown, dog. Crackers. But yeah, that's crazy.
Oh, God.
He'll be fired soon.
Just know.
Look at him, man.
If you run anywhere else, sir. You have my motherfucking vote. You hear me,
crackers.
Sir?
Definitely. Crackers.
Brian Flores is suing the Miami Dolphins and the NFL for racist and unfair hiring practices. They tried to bribe him into throwing games. He's even listing an instance where he was interviewing for the Giants job, and Coach Belichick texted him congratulations, thinking he was another coach. This is a day before he even fucking interviewed, which means that his interview was just a formality.
Yeah.
They knew who they were giving the job to already. The Rooney Rule, right? Yeah. And if you're not familiar with the Rooney Rule is that every NFL team, whenever they're hiring for coaches, has to interview one minority coach. I learned yesterday that's recently been changed to two minority coaches now.
Yeah.
They have to interview two minority coaches and two general management. But most of the times they're a formality. And when I watched Skip and Shannon yesterday, they asked a great question. Because what he was doing is he's hoping that now he did a class action suit, meaning that people can join along. Yeah. So he's hoping that other black coach say, yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Do you think that a right? Last year there were 8 black coaches in the NFL. This year, fucking one. Yeah, right?
There's only one out of
so
the 32.
So he clearly isn't the only nigga going through
there's
this.
There's one that's joining him. Hugh Jackson.
Hugh Jackson joined. Yeah. I saw his interview yesterday. Profound interview.
Yeah.
And he's spilling the fucking beans.
Yeah. He's ready. He's ready to go to war.
So now, do you think that A,
more niggas will join their side? And B, will this be effective at all in making change?
I don't think. I have friends who are coaches. There's nobody else. I don't think anybody else will join, because the NFL, not only the NFL, but in coaching, it's a fraternity. You know, it's hard to get in that motherfucker, but it's easy to get out.
Yeah.
And so you kind of want to, you don't want to ruin those relationships. These two guys will never coach again. So if you're joining, if you're going to join this fight, you ask for a good cause.
You better have a good savings.
But just know you have to have a backup career. And some of these guys is all they know. You know, I don't play football anymore. All I know is the game. I got to coach it.
Yeah.
And they make good money coaching it. Whether they're a head coach or they're an assistant coach, they make good money, you know, coaching. So I don't foresee anybody. Unless it's a black guy who's on his way out. You know, it's like.
You have to be a nigga like Kaepernick who's willing to give it all up when even you still have some more left in you.
Yeah.
Because he's not playing any more fucking games. He's done. He's fucking done.
No, I was just going to say that this shit is like a religion, bro, and they're offending it. This is blasphemous behavior.
Right, yeah. Right.
This shit is blasphemous behavior, and just like y'all said, they're not going to work again.
You remember what the Houston Texans owner said when Kaepernick and all those guys was kneeling? He was like, we can't have the prisoners running the asylum, and that's how those owners look at it. And Brian Flores, he was unjustly fired. The guy had two winning seasons. He was a coach in the Miami Dolphins twice. This is the first time Miami Dolphins had two back-to-back winning seasons since the early 2000s.
And, like, who believes, like, who finds it hard to believe that niggas in the NFL are throwing games? I believe it. I'm sure it's common practice.
It's for common practice in all levels of sports. It's just big money.
You
shouldn't be talking about it. It's crazy, though. What's crazy is the fact that it's coming from the owner. The reason why is because you still got to look at it. It's an investment. You bought the team. That's an investment. For you to want to lose games for whatever reason, it's sick.
But
there's players.
It's different. Like, it's not like we're Arizona. Miami's going to make money whether or not they win games.
Yeah,
the Cowboys have been the most winning, like the most money-making franchise
forever.
For the past two decades.
And they haven't won shit.
So it really is like Stephen Ross, as long as he's hitting that fucking bottom line, there's a live in the fucking stadium. It's gonna be filled up. Motherfuckers are gonna go.
It's just a piece of shit thing.
It's a piece of shit.
What if he has a gambling problem?
Yeah.
And he's, you know what I'm saying, betting on his own team.
You don't understand. You understand.
Yeah, shit.
And then those draft picks, they build excitement, they build hype, you get to infuse new energy and fuck up the money again. Honestly, there might be, like, a losing team, a team is the same money without the expectations.
One of my homeboys, he used to play. He said, man, as a former player hearing that shit, it makes you like want to kill that motherfucker. Because here you are putting your body on the line.
Yeah.
You're doing all this shit, you know what I'm saying, putting your health on the line. And this motherfucker is behind you.
Calling the wrong plays on purpose.
Like, trying to throw a game, bro. Like, that's just crazy, bro. Like,
nah, but you know what? We get too much credit to the cracker. Like, how can you be above the nigga and you created the nigga in the first place? Which means you had to have a little nigga in you to create the nigga. You a nigga. You just a nigga with a whole bunch of money. You throwing games, you gambling, you rolling dice, you fucking shits up. You a nigga. Like, niggas fuck up bank accounts. Crackers fuck up whole economies. Like, that's some nigga shit.
That's ridiculous, bro.
That's true.
You can't be above the nigga. You created the nigga. The whole Frankenstein thing.
This shit is crazy,
because, bro,
this shit is disgusting, bro.
Like I said on the Patreon, bro, for the past 60 years, the NFL has had 70% black players. Mm. So how is it that the only niggas qualified to teach this shit are crackers when they can't even get in the game? You've never even been good enough to do this shit. For decades now, it's only been niggas.
Bro,
all
the best players in the NFL since we've been alive have usually been black. But out of the 32 NFL teams, there's one black head coach and two general managers that are black? One was just hired last week. That shit don't make sense to me, man.
It's the white boys club.
Even if I'm watching TV, I'm watching analysts and announcers. Motherfucker, what did you play?
What did you, bro? Fucking Trent Dilfer is on TV talking to me about football. I know more about football than fucking Trent Dilfer.
Who are you to tell me that this guy's not good?
Fucking Trent Dilfer?
Get the fuck out of here.
Come on, man. Come on, man. Get the fuck out of here. Get the fuck out of here. Meanwhile, this is why I'm starting to watch the NBA now. I know their names. I'm getting into it. 16 black coaches over there.
Yeah.
16.
It's a lot more diverse.
That's almost half.
There's definitely racism in there too. No. Yeah, a lot more diverse.
It's
and
America.
More, yeah, okay. It's America, yeah.
There's going to be some racism, because, but at least.
Because to be honest, the Steve Nash hiring as head coach for the Nets doesn't make sense.
No, it doesn't.
He never coached a fucking minute in his fucking life.
Crackers love Steve Nash.
They love him.
Okay.
Got the job in an instant.
What's the fucking cracker that was talking about coming to America? But it was like, that's their one. Whenever you mention Cassius Ali, that's their one. That's what they mentioned. Steve Nash is their one.
You talking about the boxer?
Yeah, I forget his fucking name.
Fucking Marciano.
Marciano. Yeah, every time. Rocky Marciano. Fucking Steve Nash is their one. You were talking about Marciano.
Marciano.
But like, there's none of that shit. Even the NBA has one black owner. I don't think the NFL will ever have a black owner.
Who's the black owner?
Michael Jordan.
Oh, he's like a shared owner, right? He's like the actual owner.
I want to say he's majority, though, no?
I don't know. I'm not sure.
I hope.
I thought he got like a Jay-Z deal. I'm not
interested. No. He's really there.
Another motherfucker they're coming for too, Jay-Z. With your little seat at the table, what did it do?
Because you remember when we first discussed his NFL deal, everybody here was gracious. We were like, let's see what he's doing.
I said,
we can't say it's nothingness.
Niggas was happy. You know, he got his little seat at the table.
It's been a year. And the only change is Dr. Dre at the goddamn Super Bowl. Is that what you got there for?
Because
we forgot about Dre? Is that why you're there?
Fuck
out of here.
Yeah. It'll be nice to hold somebody accountable, though. We really should do that as a community more often.
Well, the powers that be, it's hard to hold somebody accountable because they're so powerful, people are going to be afraid to challenge them. That's the thing. People are afraid of the recourse.
But there are also a great deal of us that put, like, capitalism over change. Like, when niggas sell out for money, there's a good chunk of us that relate to it.
Yeah.
And would do it if we were them.
Come on.
So we can't hold them accountable. You understand? Sure. Because if you would let money make you a slave, then when somebody else does it, all you can do is understand and relate. So how could you hold that person accountable when you wish you were them?
Fact.
She's
fact,
fucked
fact.
Up.
That's fact.
Because, like, if Jay-Z fucks this up, or like doesn't do anything for us, but made $2 million for the project. How many niggas would sympathize with that? How many niggas would say he getting money though? I fucking hate that phrase.
Nah.
Like whenever I be talking rap or talking sports, and niggas say he got money though, I just want to fight.
Yeah.
I just want to fight.
The money is the end all be all. Come on, like man. To your scruples and your morals and your principles. I'm gonna tell you how even sad it gets. One of the most disturbing comments I've ever seen on my social media platform is when the Trayvon Martin situation just happened, right? And then a dude came on and said, we was like, we were boycotting Black Friday. And nigga said, you think I'm finna miss out on the TV because this nigga died? Oh. That shit burnt me, yo.
But bro, here's the thing.
Wow.
I respect the nigga with the audacity. Sometimes it's stupidity. Maybe he don't know it was audacious. But like, say it if it's on your chest. Don't be the kind of nigga that pretend you like me in being Black Friday.
Yeah.
If you an ignorant nigga, be that. So I know where you stand. This nigga said, you think I'm going to miss out
on a TV?
Speaking of which, why you niggas buy TVs every year? What happened to your old TV?
Niggas is buying TVs every year.
I buy a TV for 3 years. It works fine.
Where the TVs going?
What you niggas doing?
I don't get it. And why is it called Black Friday? Seriously, that's like, I'm not even trying to, like, why is it Black Friday? Like, I want to know, I want to debunk what it is.
I've heard a lot of things on it, but
because
I don't
know. Because
shit's on sale. Yeah.
Crazy. Fucking Wells Fargo has frozen Wendy Williams' assets per the Neighborhood Talk blog because of what they deem could be a situation where her finances are being mismanaged due to what they call dementia or other unspecified sickness, right? Yeah. So it's not who knows what she has or what the deal is, but they're locking up her money for that reason. For the past year, it's been reports. She hasn't been on her show in a minute. Reports of her doing unwell, reports of her in and out of rehab. What the fuck do you make of this?
Hold on. Not her family, Wells Fargo.
Wells Fargo froze it. Yeah. They froze it. Right.
Get the fuck out of here.
That's weird. That's weird.
Yeah.
I don't understand that. I thought it was them reporting it.
Well, maybe.
No, Wells Fargo took it upon themselves to freeze her shit.
Do you think they've probably done that to probably because. Maybe lawyers got involved and said, hey, she's not well right now. She's not in a state.
Yeah, they
got
to come from the family.
No, you're fine. She's not in a state of mind to make financial decisions. So to protect her from, you know, losing,
You know what I'm saying? Let's freeze it until we can get some more clarity. I don't think the bank could just say, make that decision and just say, yo, you can't touch the money.
I mean, I do know if you take out like 10 bands, they'll send something to the IRS and then they'll start an investigation.
Anything over $9,999.
Maybe they saw like some real sporadic activity in the account.
Here it is. Wendy Williams demands Wells Fargo unfreezes her accounts that are being held millions of dollars. Bank says it's legal to prevent misuse of funds due to her dementia. So they took it upon themselves to do it. Apparently, it's legally within their right. But the thing is, if I didn't tell you I got dementia, who told you I got dementia?
Right.
Yeah.
That's white and I say so. That's white and I say so.
This is the thing, right? Unfortunately, keeping your money in the mattress has its upsides and downsides. Right? Because when you got all your money in your mattress, nobody can do this to you. But
the money's never yours.
Not unless you're sitting
bank,
on top of it.
If it's in the bank, it's never yours, bro.
But that's the thing. But
if you can fucking tell me that I can't touch my money because you think or somebody told you I have a sickness, that ain't my money.
But also, how could you sleep comfortably with $30 million in your house? I couldn't rest.
Yeah, there's no way. There's no way.
It needs to be somewhere. It can't be here. It can't be here.
You can't leave. You will never be able to leave. You'd be going crazy.
Like a hen on some fucking eggs. You can't leave.
Fuck that.
Yeah, no. Shit, I had $20,000 in my bank and one time.
What the fuck?
No, $20,000 in my safe one time. And I was like, put this shit back in the bank, man.
Yeah.
Shit, like a fire can fucking start. And exactly. Put this shit back in the bank, man.
Yeah.
That's another thing. If your money get fucked up in the bank, at least somebody had to give it to you back. Mm-hmm. If it burned in a house fire, you just got to take an L.
You down bad.
Officer, you got to take an L.
Officer, it was $20,000. How much you say it was?
Sure. Sure, pal. Sure, pal.
Yo, off topic. Don't got shit to do with shit. But y'all know that if you ride around with that much cash, police could confiscate it?
Yeah, just take it. It happened to me before.
Yeah. No, you fucking lying.
When I got, it wasn't $20,000. It was probably about $2,000 or $3,000. I got pulled over with my mom. I was taking my mom to church, and I had an expired tag, and I had like $3,000 because I was about to put down on an apartment.
Yeah.
The next day, they pull me over. They take my car. They take my license from me, and they take the money.
What was the reason, nigga?
Like, why are you riding around with all this cash? What was the reason I got pulled over?
No, no. What was the reason for them taking the money from you?
They searched my car for everything because I had this expired tag, suspended license.
Oh, so you agree,
they searched everything. They saw my cash. They took the cash. They took my license.
For all they knew,
were you able to get the money back?
No. Drug kingpin.
What do you mean?
Nope.
It goes to the police department.
Yeah, it goes to the police
department. To funding new bulletproof vests and dogs.
You didn't get that money back?
No. You don't get the money back.
Go on YouTube and watch videos of people losing big money, bro. Like,
the guy
big
said,
money.
The first thing the guy said to me, what are you doing with... I was sitting down on the sidewalk, and he's like, what are you doing with all this cash? I said, that's my money. He said, what are you doing with all this cash? I said, that's my money. That was the last I saw of it. I saw that money.
I know you make this a month, officer, but give me a fucking break.
I'm sure he cut it in half with the lady that was with him.
Oh, no, let me tell you something. Total, I've maybe had an ounce of weed total confiscated in Miami. I don't ever believe in seeing a fucking evidence lock up. You hear me? Okay? They're selling. They're putting it on the street. They're selling.
On the side of the road with no car, and I just find a ride home.
Whenever your plug is getting deals too good to be true, he's buying it from the police. You heard it here first.
It took my motherfucking money.
Facts.
The guy's like, you want to go to jail? I was like, no, I don't want to go to jail, but I want my money. If you're going to take my car, at least let me have my money. Shit.
Think about how much cocaine is confiscated off Calle Ocho alone. Okay? Off South Beach alone.
Nigga, off those fucking boats, nigga? Come on. It's never... Whatever they report on the news, 75% of that shit is...
I finally watched the fucking Cocaine Cowboys.
Yeah, I watched it too.
I had no concept of how much money. No. I didn't have a real concept of it.
Yeah. Talk about money in houses. Them niggas
Which
was,
one? One or two? I'm sorry. One two. Or two?
These niggas were dealing dope pre-DEA.
Yeah.
Oh, come on, guys! Ooh. Before there was a process to find this shit.
They're the reason why there's... Okay.
These niggas have boats and cousins in Cuba. What else do you need?
Shit was crazy.
At that time, nothing.
The fucking shootout that they had, and they found all that fucking artillery.
Yeah.
Like, they had to put
the first one was crazy, too, with Griselda Blanco.
I haven't seen hers.
Oh.
Well, part two goes when she goes to jail and she meets the California dude.
Yeah.
And then they start...
Oh, so that probably saw part one.
Part one is ridiculous.
It's insane.
Yeah, it's insane.
Knowing that these streets that we walk
is the reason
built by cocaine.
Yeah. All of Miami, this is built off.
Better yet, knowing that all these damn Jimenezes that we have in government have uncles that was moving bricks just a generation ago.
Big bricks.
So big bricks pay for college education. College education gets you in the fucking government, and then you recycle, baby.
Yeah, that whole Scarface era.
The Italians, the fucking Irish, rinse and repeat.
No, you go out west until
Zoe Pound. Where's your bricks? Where's your politicians? What are we doing, Zopal? What are we doing?
At the office.
I watched a 60 minutes episode one time about the fraud that was going on in Miami.
I'm disgusted already. Right? I know where you're going. I'm disgusted already.
They said that it was estimated $18 million taken from these tax frauds, right? And they knew where it was coming from. They couldn't stop it because it was being done online. Where the fuck the businesses came at
out of 18 million
scammed out of Miami. Miami alone.
Nigga, be more specific. The north part of Miami. Let's get specific. Toward the beach. Let's get more specific.
The northern part.
Listen, because if you want to keep it a buck, these Cubans specifically, they were able to build South Beach. Shit, they built the Grove. They built fucking Little Havana. And they built fucking, what's the other shit, bro? Southwest. Just pretty much anything Southwest is theirs anyway.
Yeah.
All of this shit is built by cocaine and the flips and the businesses that were bought with cocaine money. It was strategic.
Come on, bro.
Like, I literally watched niggas in my generation run up millies. I've been in the strip clubs watching them fuck it off.
BBLs, bro.
Before BBLs.
Oh, like you throwing rocks at the chain gang. You risking your freedom to only get this money and give it back to the cracker. That's white supremacy. That's white supremacy all day. You out here selling whatever you doing, do whatever you're doing illegally, right? Risking your freedom and then take that money and give it right back to the crackers instead of investing that and putting that in your community and building up, like getting the Birkin bags and all that shit. That's just white supremacy, man.
Shit's stupid.
BBL.
Making a white man richer.
Speaking of building your community.
That's how they build in the community.
Nick Cannon's about to have another baby.
Yo, is he sick?
What, he on like number 11? He on number 11? Hey, I ain't mad at him.
Is
hey,
he by I black knew women? You wouldn't by black
women?
I brought it up.
Wait, by black women?
You know fucking better than that.
Oh,
you know better
he said,
than that.
He said that he's actually very sensitive towards the subject of how people make fun of his many different children.
That's crazy. I'm but so sorry,
but is he dying or something? Like, honestly,
he's
been dying for 10 years now, bro. He's here.
He got something.
What is
sickle cell? But he's not going anywhere.
But why is he doing this? Like, what is he saying? Why he's doing this? Like, it's kind of, it's not normal to just be doing this shit that he's doing. Like, niggas be having babies and shit, but the way he's doing it seems like it's like a.
Let me ask you a question. Why would you be afraid to have babies all over the place?
How do you fucking raise them? I it's hard to raise the two that I have them, so I'm trying to think, like, doing it this way, like, back-to-back, the way he's fucking doing it, and with all these different women,
because
that's just got to be fucking taxing, bro.
You know, the thing is, I'd venture to say that with the kids he have now, he's not custodial for any of them.
No,
he's financial.
Not. So typically, my obligation is writing a check and pulling up on the day of the month that I can.
Yeah.
But I'm saying, but what does he get out of that? Like, that's what I'm saying.
It's an experiment. I mean, I'm sure
that's
a
hell of an experiment.
I would like to see what I look like in Chinese. I'm not going to do it. I would love to see it. I would love to see what Puerto Rican Plus look like. I'm not going to create a life for the experiment. I would love to see what Brazilian Plus looks like. It's interesting.
We know what Dominican Ben looks like on the fucking logo.
But I would love to try every race and just see what I would look like. See what I would shoot at.
That's hilarious.
You know?
See what I shoot at.
See what I shoot at.
That's not the name of the episode. See what I shoot at.
The fuck? Imagine a little Indian Haitian baby. Fire! So hardworking. Fire! A little Mexican Haitian. Fire!
Thank you, Vinny Uncle.
Yeah, fuck you, bro. Fuck you, dog. Fuck you, dog.
So dumb, dog.
So Nick is out here just experimenting, bro. He's just putting his babies through different filters, I guess.
That's crazy, man. I thought he was dying or something, and he wanted to like leave a legacy or some shit. I don't know.
Because if you're about to die, that's even more irresponsible.
That's what I'm saying.
18 that's what I'm saying, bro.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
because you know, money makes raising children easier.
Shit,
but it doesn't make it easy. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Like, because compared to broke, it's easier. but it's still never not easy. Easy.
It's never easy, yeah.
Because kids have problems that just money can't fix. Like, come on.
Yeah. True. Like they're humans. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. So
this is like, a weird, like, little kick that he's on, that he's doing this shit.
Not to answer your question, for me, why wouldn't do no shit like that? I'll be scared of the ideologies of what they picking up, the experiences. Like, as a protector, as a man, I want to know what my children are being exposed to. And with this many women and the way they think and their family members, your child could be getting molested. And it's a whole bunch of shit, man. Like, yeah, you can't.
Has your influence.
Yeah, when you're not under the same roof as you.
Of course. I mean, but here's the thing. Even if you can't, because you can't realistically dedicate the time needed to make an influence.
I would disagree. I would disagree to a certain extent. To a certain extent, because the outside is always going to have that influence. It's always going to have that influence.
How can you properly influence 12 children that you don't live with?
No. I'm saying if you live with them.
If you live with them, you can have as many as you want.
Yeah, that's why I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't venture in having all these children outside by these women. Like, nah, because the influence is not going
to
be there.
So then, as long as they're in the house, you have 24 kids.
Oh yeah, yeah.
This nigga,
be fruitful and prosper.
I bet you will.
Fruitful and prosper. Listen, funny you say that. There was an African warrior, can't think of his name right now, when they was fighting the Portuguese. He had damn near close to 50 children. His grandchildren came out to like 200-something. And his children alone fought against the Portuguese. This man created a whole fucking army. Wow. Look it up, man. Look it up. So, yeah.
That's gangster shit.
That's amazing as fuck.
That's gangster for real.
That means there's no bitch in your bloodline. Everybody fought? Yeah. Everybody threw hands? Wow.
Everybody came back with a clip empty, nigga.
Let's see who else we got here.
I thought you never talk about African warriors and shit like that. Like, I never heard no.
Ain't no white man never did that.
So I didn't begin to even hear about African wars until I was on my Castro shit and reading into his bio and then reading the amount of goons he was sending to Africa to fight wars. Because Africans love these niggas. And it's like, they're a hell of Cuban hybrids. I'm like, how the hell are there Cuban hybrids in Africa? This nigga sending over Cuban men to fight wars.
Yeah, big fact. Helped free about 12 African countries from colonialism.
Who, Castro?
Castro.
And Cuban soldiers.
Yeah, Cuban soldiers.
Come on, you from Miami. You would never know this information.
Because we was taught to hate Castro.
Yeah. Cubans would never tell you that this nigga went to Africa, was gangbanging, sent Shay, his right-hand nigga, and a bunch of goons, go fight until shit's right.
And it's not, and I don't want to say he did it because he liked black people.
He had an influence.
It was a chess move. He had an influence with Russia, the United States, that whole Cold War situation. Right. So how can we fuck over the United States and the UK? Help free up them African countries from their rule. So that was more or less the way he was doing it. But it was still a gangster, though.
Yeah.
You got to give him credit. It was gangster as fuck.
Because they're tiny. You know what I mean? Yeah. Yeah. So it's like when you're this big and you're sending out doctors and sending out soldiers, and mind you, soldiers that they were getting from the fucking Soviet. Mm-hmm. Because the niggas were sending over 50,000 fucking soldiers to fucking Cuba, and then Cuba's fucking all over Africa.
That's why Haiti catches a lot of hell too. A lot of people don't know. That's why Haiti catches a lot of hell with that whole Soviet. Matter of fact, there was a tweet that went out to Russia, to the president of Haiti before he was assassinated, telling him, hey, if y'all need some help, we got you. And he ain't shut that down. So that whole virus thing and the contact with Russia is a lot of reasons why he was assassinated. The idea that you are trying to bring the Soviet Union back into the Caribbean, our territory. They don't play that. They don't play that about that, man.
Shit, get deep.
All right. I know you guys don't care about this, but Nicki Minaj and City Girls have ended their feud.
They were feuding?
So people on the internet have been begging for them to collaborate for a long time. But very early in the game, City Girls chose Team Cardi. And they were making kind of, you know, slick, disparaging comments toward Nicki, but you can't hide shit on the internet.
Okay.
So it's like, you know, Nicki's the queen bee. She's the pinnacle of female rap. She don't need a City Girl feature. It's the other way around.
Right.
So she was asked in the interview why she don't fuck with them anymore. I'm not going to play it. Fuck it. No, don't bother. It's long as shit. Nobody cares. Nobody cares. And she was basically, because they've been throwing shots and shit, they must have reached out, apologized. Word is that Young Miami had Diddy intervene. You know, put that pussy to use.
Yeah.
Put that pussy to use. And Diddy bop all over there and did what he did. take that. And so we should be expecting a collaboration soon.
Diddy loves young pussy.
Yay.
Good for him though, huh?
Good for him. Love him.
He deserves it. He works very hard. He gave us more money, more problems. He deserves it. Anybody here ever play Saucy Santana?
Is that the Rick Ross gay
yeah,
guy?
Yeah, yeah.
Like Rick Ross? You're in a room by yourself.
I know. I just want to know.
Rick Ross gay guy?
No, it's a guy who looks like him. It's a guy who looks like, he looks like Rick Ross. He looks like Plus, but he's gay.
Watch your mouth.
You know, a Miami dude with a beard.
He's a very muscular, no, I wouldn't say muscular. He's a solidly big, built.
He's butt broken. Bearded. Yeah. White supremacy has gotten to him. He's butt broken.
Yeah, a lot of, he likes a lot of white.
Oh, all right.
Supremacy.
And this last, I want to play you guys this clip. From this actor, Thandiwe Newton, who felt the need to apologize to every dark-skinned actress for not representing them well. Wait until you hear this crock of shit. Wait until you hear these fucking light-skinned tears. All right? This bullshit.
I wanted so desperately to apologize. Wait, every day.
She's from London.
To dark-skinned actresses. To say I'm sorry that I'm chose. I'm the one chosen. My mama looks like you.
The hair going down for me. Oh. The hair going down.
Jesus.
My mom looks like you. And
why does she feel the need to do this?
It's been very painful to have women that look like my mum. Feel like I'm not representing them. That I'm taking from them. Taking their men. Taking their work.
Taking their men.
Taking their truth.
We talk about actresses at first. She's slipping, taking their men. She's been holding on to light-skinned beef all her life.
I didn't mean to, you know.
So essentially, she feels guilty about representing darker-skinned women in roles, knowing that some women are accusing her of not representing her, I guess, them properly. And she feels guilty about that.
Yeah, because her mom is black.
But not guilty enough not to take the role and give it to somebody else.
I mean, it's a valid point, though. It's a valid point. Well, there are women who suffer with the skin complexion thing. There are some men who suffer with it. And, you know, so I get a point, but yeah.
We didn't need it, though.
Nah, it wasn't necessary.
I just don't believe you feel that bad about it. I don't believe you feel that sorry.
I think she was on something.
Even if she does feel that sorry, we don't
true. Yeah. Yeah. I'm
not going to change my fucking day.
Yeah. Like, we didn't need it, bro. Like,
I think the shrooms got her extra emotional, and she just got to thinking about how she's been portraying these black
women. I'm going to be honest. I don't give a fuck about anything she said. Her accent fucked me all up.
Yeah. My mom. Did she play in Four Color Girls or some shit like that?
She played in a lot of, like... Yeah.
She plays on the HBO show right now.
Can you name it?
The Western.
I don't know where she's from.
I feel like she was also in. You know, I'm just getting her and Zoe Saldana mixed up with all.
She was in the movie with She was in the movie with Idris Elba.
Zoe Saldana B side.
That's she feels like evil Zoe Saldana.
Yeah,
she was in a movie with Idris Elba where she was it Idris Elba? Oh you no, see? With Tyler Perry where you she was like remember. A maid or some shit. I don't know. She's like a.
She'd have been in a Tyler Perry.
How the fuck
movie.
Do they go in and out of that accent? Like that shit
that's
is
talent, bro.
From what I understand, that's like talent. their training as actors is a lot more rigorous and serious than American shit is. Mm. And then also, America exports bullshit and entertainment.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Which means that we're not importing British shows, but they watch a shit ton of American TV, meaning much more opportunities. Like the same way we could all turn on and turn off our Haitian accent because we've been hearing it all of our lives.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Same thing with them. If you've been watching fucking American TV your whole life, then you'll be able to do something. Yeah. All right. Speaking of this shit, because it's actually going to bring us to our topic of today. The other week, I was on fucking Twitter at like 3 a.m. And Tariq Nasheed had a space going, and he was asking, does immigration benefit foundational black Americans? Now, I didn't know what foundational black Americans were, so I just kind of wanted to go in there for context. And from what I was able to understand, foundational black Americans are direct descendants of people who were slaves in America. Is that fair? Is that right?
Yeah, African Americans.
Yeah. So pretty much foundational black, they're the descendants of the people that built this country. Okay. And they see lumping in every black person under this black umbrella and not separating themselves as detrimental because then they feel like they'll never get those benefits reserved for being a descendant of these people. So it's like so African, Jamaican, Haitian niggas, like you niggas are in a different category. We may look alike. Our noses are wide. but you're from over there and you can go home. You can go speak another country. If this country burns down, you have a home that they can go to, is the point that they kept repeating, is that they have nowhere else to go to. This is their home. If shit goes under, you can go to Haiti and live in a shack for free.
Right.
And I can't speak to most of it because I can't sympathize. You understand? I can't understand that feeling. I do see it as counterproductive, but also, of course I would. I'm a black immigrant, the ones that they're talking about.
Right. It sounds divisive, though.
It is divisive, but also, okay, I wouldn't be fair if I didn't say that Africans that come here, Haitians that come here, have a lot of cool-ass ways of thinking.
Oh, yeah.
Facts. Right? Facts.
And they come here and they try to be the good nigga.
Facts.
You know what I mean? And they take some of those bad habits and they also spew a lot of anti-black shit.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So it's like, that's what they're referring to. Unfortunately, it's not all of us, but everybody has their coons.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking to myself, like, if I'm using my logical mind, like completely separating myself and trying to think objectively, I can't really dislike their position.
Because
I can't dislike it.
They were speaking about people like Candace Owens, who's of Haitian descent, who went up there and was sick. Yeah, she's one of us.
She got some type of Caribbean background. I don't know if it's Haitian.
It's Haitian. It's us.
Ah, shit. We got to take Candace
Owens. She married to a cracker. Adopted and married to a cracker. Right? So, but like, she was up there caping and saying that African Americans shouldn't get reparations. And they're like, bitch, you Haitian. That's none of your business. And they're right.
They're right.
They're right.
Hey, you got to call it how you see it.
You're right. That's none of your fucking business.
True.
Don't fix your mouth. Right? But even though I would never tell no nigga, no matter where you from, no matter you don't deserve reparations.
Come on, that's crazy. Right.
No matter where you are, if you're a nigga who can get it, get it.
Yeah.
Get it.
They even pointed out the dude with the hairline from ESPN.
Stephen A. Smith.
Yeah,
Smith.
They say he Caribbean. Right?
He is of... Some
Saint Kirk Virgin or some shit like that.
Oh, really?
So they're like pointing out the way that Caribbean people come in and influence and then come with that coon shit and saying y'all fucking up what we got here in America, right? And it, you know, so it's hard
to disprove because the thing is, like, Stephen A. Smith is hard on black men, and the thing is, it should come from a black person, right? But also, when you come out there and you begin to say shit that doesn't align with. I don't know. The whole shit's funny. I don't even know if I should finish that statement.
I just find it divisive. I just feel like in the greater scheme, it's division, bro. Like,
okay, so
we're
now,
still oppressed.
I've also seen a group of guys called ADOS, American Descendants of Slavery. Now, how do ADOS and foundational black Americans, like, are they, like, how do their stances differ?
Well, one is more of a political group, and I can only speak for as an outsider.
Right.
I'm speaking as an outsider. So one is a political group, that's ADOS, right? They allow other people to come in who are not of that. And Foundation of Black American is more of a lineage, is an identity. Like, you can't be a part of this. Like, the same way, you know, Haitian Americans, et cetera, the same way, right? But to touch on Ricky, I'll be remiss if I don't, look, I'm using words like remiss.
Come on, baby.
If I don't say this, we can say that their stance is divisive right now. But at times, Caribbean people in contact with Africans have been divisive.
Of course.
So right now, they're saying we are circling the wagons, and we're saying we identify, okay, you belong to that group, you belong to that group, this is our group, and we're going to protect and build up our group. I have no issue with that. The part that gets divisive to me is when we just start disparaging each other, calling each other names and this and that and your country and go back to this and go back to that. That sounds like some white supremacist shit to me.
I hate to hear my American brothers and sisters say that crazy shit. It sounds crazy.
Hearing
black people say go back to your country. Yeah. It always sounds crazy as fuck to me.
I never understood it.
Let's not cap, though. We definitely heard that all throughout school.
Yeah.
But
that's another point. I don't mean the ball hog. That's another point that I feel, right? I think that this conversation, it becomes nationalized and regionalized, right, in a certain degree. like the way that Haitians were treated in Miami is different from when they were treated in New York, how they were treated in Boston. Yeah. So when I hear some people say things like, well, African Americans have always been loving and welcome. Shit, speak, man, for your region.
Now, okay,
speak
but now where you come we from. Also have to remember, right? Because this is, and I got this shit from you, right? This is never letting white supremacy off the hook.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
Because the thing is, these kids that did this shit and they were saying these things, these weren't innate.
Right.
They weren't, these things were taught to them.
Yeah.
Right. Via
miseducation, yeah, via TV, mm-hmm, via cool slur parents, campaigns about cool Africa. Parents. Mm-hmm. Through parents and their parents
AIDS, educated the same patients way. Coming with AIDS, yeah, in the '80s. That was all through the news.
Yeah, but that's the thing. So it's like,
it's fucked up,
when a miseducated motherfucker is stupid and ignorant, I don't know if I should be mad at you or the miseducator.
Right.
And then also, these niggas were 5 and 6. We were in high school. Yeah. All of us are better people now, I would hope.
I would hope so. I would definitely hope so. But we see that this is permeating amongst the community. I only see long term damage. I don't see anything wrong with recognizing our differences. I don't see anything wrong with recognizing that we are of African heritage, right? But we all have different connections to that certain thing. I don't see an issue with that, you know. Rep your shit, you know, do your thing. Just when it comes down to the divisiveness and go back to your country.
Yeah,
and,
that shit's crazy.
You know, we gotta admit we got some coons. I stand on that.
Oh,
we got
boy,
some coons
a lot.
In our, do we have
in our, yeah,
I a know lot. For like I
some
know,
of them. Some of us need to go back to our country.
Because, no, bro, I know because of Haiti's problems. Some Haitians do believe that the white man's water is colder. I know they believe.
Yeah.
Jamaicans too, bro.
You understand?
Yeah.
Because we're the most bleachingest islands in the Caribbean.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? Because of those problems specifically.
Right.
So it's like
right.
When you're raised that way and then you come here and the crackers tell you, hey man, you're doing great, Rickinson, at that job. You see, mm-hmm, those niggas over there hanging out, having a good time? Don't be like those niggas. Right. Be a different kind of nigga.
How many times
how can that not permeate something different?
How many times have I told you guys, you know, I was, you know, managing at my job with the Haitians versus how they deal with me, versus how they deal when they see the cracker.
Of course.
You ain't gotta respect the Haitian bosses. They Haitian, fuck them. When that cracker come in here, oh shit.
Right. And you know what?
Oh shit.
You made a valid point. I think that's another conversation. I don't want to take away from the foundation of Black America. It is a conversation. But that's another conversation that we need to look at, how Haitians or diaspora people are looked at as well. Because when we go to Haiti, sometimes we're not looked at as Haitian as well. When you go to Jamaica, we looked at it as something different. Jaspoa, right? Yeah. So that's another
Haitians
conversation.
Will literally call you blunt.
Right. Yeah.
Which
right.
means white.
Right.
Yeah. When I go back to Haiti, and they can smell it on you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Because I go out of my way to try to dress like a nigga who's from there when I go.
Right.
You understand?
Shorts,
no chains, no shit. Some slides, some shorts.
Real simple.
They still see you.
I'll even go bigger than this. I've met Haitian girls who come from Haiti who don't really date us. Like Haitian Americans, they don't really date us. They date the Haitian men.
Yeah.
Right? So that's another conversation for another time. But just adding more nuance to the conversation about, it's not just particularly we don't like African Americans. I think what happens is, since it's their land, they've been here the longest, other African groups come here and we already got hate and vitriol and disdain, mm-hmm, and self-hate in us. And we come here, we project it on top of them. And since they're not, for the most part, not saying, oh, not traveling out to see how they're accepted and received by other Africans around the world, they get these coon motherfuckers that come here and just dumping on them. And it's like, nah, the world is bigger than that.
Yeah.
Like, we fuck with you outside of like, this, right?
Like, the Africans that you see here, it's not Africa.
It's
like,
not
you
Africa.
You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. Because one Nigerian shot on you is not Nigeria.
Yeah, it's not. No,
right,
it's not.
Right.
And I think I tweeted something similar to the point that I'm about to make. I was like, all the people that you hate on or have a some type of gripe with is a very, very microscopic percentage of the people overall. You got to understand that that's just one experience that you had with somebody who's from a community. It's, go out and actually learn what that community is about. So, like, two more things.
Please,
to piggyback off of what you said about certain Haitian women not really wanting to fuck with the Haitian Americans. Funny story. I went to some Haitian club in Fort Lauderdale. It was off of State Road 84. What was it called again? Atrium?
Atrium.
Atrium. Nigga, I'm there. I see this Haitian dom that I want to go and dance with on the dance floor. I go out to her And I could immediately tell, okay, all right, she probably from the land.
Right.
The look that she you gave me about the on disgust, her neck. Bro. It was there, too. The look of disgust that she gave me, bro.
Yeah.
You don't remember this?
No.
They say that niggas from Haiti dance better than us. They say that. Yeah. Because she said that compa is homegrown.
Yeah, yeah.
That Guyat is homegrown.
And second thing, to piggyback off of what you said, Ricky, earlier about how your interactions differ, or you see a difference in how they interact with you versus the cracker.
Yeah.
Man, if we really want to get into...
You also have management.
Listen, if you really want to get into a conversation, I don't really want to damn myself like that, but there are certain days where I feel like I'm going through some racism in my office, bro, because I feel like, man...
Yeah.
Certain people, like... When I try to hand down an order or something to do,
they have to hear from somebody else. Huh?
Yeah. They have to hear from somebody else before they actually take it a little bit more serious. Like that shit. You probably know the motherfucker I'm talking about.
You know.
Mm-hmm. I don't like it. I feel like it's racist.
Right, I feel like
it's racist.
What else could it be? Like, what else? Because it's not tenure. It's not education. What else could make them not want to listen to it?
The socialization. The idea that, nigga, you don't know shit. All my best information came from crackers. You know what I'm saying? Whether watching on YouTube, whether in school, what was the Build of Science guy? Like, you don't know shit. Everything I learned from a cracker. So when a black man come in and tell you something, you like, man, nigga, fuck out of here. I never had a nigga
teach me before. What can a Negro teach me? How to shuck? I know how to jive already.
You're black like me. I don't know, so you must not know.
I don't want to learn how to dance.
What can a Negro teach me?
I actually like that shit a lot.
It's not bad.
What can a Negro teach me?
Right. I mean, it's a heavy conversation, man. And again, to reiterate, I feel that it's going to have some long-term effects.
Like what?
Man. Geopolitical effects, man. When you look at like how Haiti, historically speaking, and kind of modern day, when you look at how like they play off of Haiti's instability and how they undercut, like when they bring Caribbean people here, they bring him with the idea to leave black people out of jobs,
yeah,
right, to undercut the black community when it comes to jobs. It's gonna have long term effects.
That's a point that the foundation of black Americans made. And it stung me because I didn't have a defense for it. They were saying how, you know, medical school programs and shit like that have a slot for four niggas in, right? And typically when you get there, the four niggas are African.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? So it's like, even though it's meant for black, like even though it was meant because affirmative action things like that are benefits for motherfuckers in this country who wouldn't get a shot otherwise. Correct. But when an immigrant comes here, takes it, and looks at you like, you don't work hard enough.
That's because white supremacy can't tell black people apart.
Because we can't let them off the hook.
No, they can tell us apart. That's the problem, Chris. Mm. They know that you come in here, you got a hungry belly, you done left your country to come here. So they are like, hey, Chris, you from Jamaica. You not like them. And that permeates in some of our minds to where we start believing that we not like them until they take little Haiti and say, you got to go. And then we get our Haitian wake-up call.
Oh, boy. Because, bro.
Crazy.
It literally happens, and mind you, like sometimes motherfuckers are escaping situations where they fighting for their life. You understand? Like if I'm in Haiti fighting for my life, and all I do is come over here and be a coon, where do I sign up? Being a coon in America is better than being poor as fucking Haiti, and unfortunately, that's what's real. That's what's real.
Yeah, I want to respect their legacy because we do stand on the shoulders of the people who laid the foundation for us to be here. Right? I think it is sometimes. A lot of us play around with that legacy that they laid down. And so I respect that. I throw that out there. They made the chips fall where they at because at this point, what you going to do? I mean, you're looking at rooms that got millions of people in it across the world arguing back and forth.
Because people are like, this is a subject like, because you know what? I feel like all niggas would like to think that we're all a part of like this big, huge black family.
Right.
Right? That like no matter what country you come from, like I can count on no matter what that I know that you and I
have
similar experience.
Until 5 minutes.
You understand what I'm saying? Like, I know no matter what country you in, the niggas followed you around the store. No matter what country you at, mm-hmm. I know that you and I have certain things. So it's like when you begin to kind of break up shit like that. It's like a wake up call of some sort. Like maybe we not all a big ass family. Maybe I need to identify who my family is.
You know what? It's interesting you said that. I had this conversation with a good friend of mine, and she and through the conversation, I don't want to get deeper too, but through the conversation, I had a realization that I am not a part of the culture. I'm a observer of the culture and a sort of sometime a participator in the culture.
And when you but first hear that, isn't that hard to hear?
It's hard to hear.
It's hard to hear.
It's very hard to hear.
Because that's not what you thought it was.
Right.
You
right,
felt
right.
like you were in there.
No, hearing this but, right now, it's like
but
fucking
when you call a spade, nigga, my culture is compa and guyot. No matter how
Yo,
much I love
rap. That shit hurt me, bro.
No matter how much I love rap, my culture isn't cornbread and ham hocks.
Right.
Even though I fuck with it,
but, right.
but I'm a sauce wine nigga.
Right.
You, know that, what I mean?
You was born in Haiti or you was born
I'm
here?
Born
no,
here.
We're born here.
Yeah, yeah.
But the culture and the foundation of what they stand on has already been laid before we got here, yeah. right? 24. So when we come here, we get in the Jordans and we get in yeah. the thing. We watching Fresh Prince, and that's us observing the culture yeah. and then mimicking the culture to a certain degree, right. but
and
not because, of the culture.
And because we look like but them, even and because they invite us
born
in, to feel
here,
like home.
Yeah,
the
even born, though, bro, this no, conversation it's, fucked it's me on, up, Chris.
It's on their backs.
To
yeah,
break it down,
man, it fucked like, me up because. Like,
but the niggas who created hip hop is Jamaicans.
They hate this. They hate
who participated.
I heard somebody said it. They
who
wanted to fight him. A UK nigga brought that up and they jumped on his head. Tariq jumped on that boy.
Participated,
head.
Not created. Participated.
Who do they credit for creating?
Cool Herc and all those. But
them niggas is from the Caribbean.
But see, that's
them niggas is us from the Caribbean.
Those foundational Black Americans they're talking about, them niggas are African. Like those Black asses that they have who built this country weren't even from this country.
Right.
All fucking African.
You know, so yeah. it's like, but.
That's why I said it should all be one.
They
We're
still have
African,
solid
bro.
Points.
They do. Yeah.
We arguing about bus stops. That's crazy.
Yeah. It comes to that, Chris, but also it's the realization that we already don't see each other as one for real.
No.
Like we really don't. So what they're saying is that you guys have never seen us as a part of your thing, right? So now we want to have our thing. And I think that's a valid point to make. I don't see anything wrong with that.
If you're a white person, you
But don't tell me I'm a participator in hip hop, motherfucker.
Because I'll say this.
I mean,
because
don't tell me I'm an observer.
Here, when we do come here, though, fuck? We open up Haitian restaurants, yeah. right? And we create these enclaves of economic stability for ourselves, Jamaican restaurants, et cetera, right? For the most part, not all, but they don't participate in our things, and we don't, for the most part, participate in their things, unless you have a African center consciousness.
They'll participate
right?
in some Chinese food, though.
That's another story, Chris. So, like, even, now I'll say now, Haitians, we have the most, that sounds very above elitist, but we have the most, like, viewpoint of seeing things. Like, Haitians, we coon, but we know America fucking up Haiti. We be knowing that instinctively. Yeah. Like, anytime something happened in Haiti, we be like, America. I know it's you, motherfucker.
If we don't know why or how, we know. Like, once Finger the president point, died, everybody knew.
Everybody was
deluded as to where it came from.
Every Haitian friend I had connected it to America immediately.
Bro,
the first thing they did when that news broke, they was like, watch out, I'm going to show you how America did.
There was never any doubt in my mind who did this shit. You know what I mean? Like, we're not deluded. Because this is the thing. Our history is littered with being fucked by America.
Yeah.
Which is why I can't understand why a Haitian would tell somebody else America to owe you, because America owes Haiti. We should be next in line for the reparation list.
Yeah.
We should.
Man. Real talk.
You know what I'm saying?
Fuck the country. I'm saying, I don't want to cut you off. I'm just saying, go back to the FBA. Is it FBA?
Yeah, FBA.
Foundation of Black Americans.
If you're a white person hearing this, you got to be ecstatic.
That's
what I'm saying. Like,
further division.
If this sounds like LA during the gang, you know what I'm saying? Like the gang times. Like, this is what you want.
They're smiling to themselves like, these niggas are never.
The most
together.
Dangerous thing that can ever happen to white people is Black people getting together and realizing some shit. But now you guys are talking about, oh, you still here, you come over here, because we get this. Nigga, like,
I'm
counterproductive.
Once Italians and Irish people and Jewish people have been in this fucking country two generations, they're white.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah. Facts.
All right? Fuck all that Rosenberg shit. I'm a white man.
You're white.
You understand me? The ones who, I guess, are religious, hold on to the Jewish faith. But other than that, like, you just blend to be white.
I just don't see how this can be viewed as non-counterproductive. Because that's what it looks like to me. As far as the bigger picture.
The FBAs, I think they're focused on the Black immigrants that are coons. And it's like, if you're focused on that, then separating yourself is definitely productive.
Y'all getting me hot. My bad. I don't want to have another episode like last time. Y'all getting me hot, dog. Let me get a fan or something to blow my figgy, boy. Yeah. Something to get some. Yeah. Y'all know I got virgin lungs right here. My bad. I don't mean to be fucking up the pod.
No, you good, bro.
I want you healthy.
Yeah. Just start going slow. Let me get a cardboard box or something, dog. Get some fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. I think it all comes down to respect and acknowledgement and realizing that people have. Because I don't play about my ancestors. Don't play about Jean-Jacques Dessalines, and I'm not going to play about somebody else. So I'm gonna give the same respect to your ancestors that I would give to the people who laid the foundation for me.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And I think that's what it comes down to, man. People be shitting on,
you don't have to do that,
on their history and their culture because they may not know it in depth, right? And yeah, just gotta show a little more respect, man, and be appreciative. Now, I'm not saying bow down or anything like that, but just, you know, show some respect, man.
And this kind of shit, like, is even making, because I love, y'all know me, I love a good light-skinned nigga joke. It's one of my favorites. It's one of my favorites. But recently, I've been seeing how, like, the jokes lead to the bullshit. You know what I mean? And, like, they keep the bullshit alive. But I love a good red nigga joke.
Yeah.
But I'm trying to slow it down. Except for when it comes to Chris.
Nah, you gotta understand. You gotta understand, this culture, everything comes from a joke, and then it becomes crystallized and made solid, right? The Ku Klux Klan, right? That started as them putting on hoods and sheets on their head and acting like spooks, like, woo, scared. And then somebody said, let's go to their house and do that. And then let's burn a cross on their shit. Like that whole Jim Crow, that shit started off as a joke. That shit in this culture starts off as a joke, and then it becomes crystallized, man. It becomes full and whole in this culture. That whole HBO, Haitian body odor, cats and things, that shit turned into, now let's go jump Haitians after school.
Yeah.
Now let's go do this and do that. That's how this culture works, man. It starts off as a joke, and then that shit becomes cemented.
Bro,
that's a whole fact.
I can appreciate and understand y'all niggas' position, but just don't call me a Haitian booty scratcher.
I'm above that now.
Fighting words.
Yeah. And you know, there's many nuances to the conversation, you know. Like, even within their culture, and I'm speaking as an outsider again, there's no one way to be a foundational Black American. Because the Southerners are different from the New Yorkers, the Midwesterners are different from the Southerners, and the Californians are different. So it all, you know, it's many different conversations to it. I think that we just got to be honest about it. We got to be open about it. Like, we all just had an epiphany, like, we not a part of the culture. We are visionaries and watching the culture and then, you know, expressing that. So I think people got to take that in, man.
You got to show me.
Chris like, fuck it, I'm a boy here.
A lot of them niggas is, like I said, a lot of them niggas is Jamaican, Trinidadian, Belizean. Like, them motherfuckers came from other places, bro.
Like, you can't pick and choose.
These is not just niggas that, nah.
Because they do that too, right? Like they'll pick and choose when it's time to call a nigga your brother.
Right.
Right? All the Caribbean niggas accomplishing shit, we brothers.
All of a sudden.
It be like that. Because when you go on some of these Haitian platforms, they, promoting the idea of Haitian. Look at a Haitian just graduated from Harvard. A Haitian just did that. A Haitian just did that. And it's kind of like a purposeful separation, right? In a certain degree. But then when a Haitian does some outlandish shit, they be like, nah, he black. He just black.
Hilarious.
He just black. Don't put that on Haitian people.
It's hilarious because I've seen it.
Yeah. So African Americans, foundation Black Americans are saying, don't do that. Claim that. If you're going to claim the good that you're doing, claim the bad that you're doing. And
that's
I can respect that.
That's
yeah, I can respect
remember,
that.
Remember growing up how Haitians used to always automatically, if they saw a black guy with dreads, black American.
Facts.
You know, always, no matter what.
Facts. I hate to agree with that. It gave me chills. I hate to agree
recently,
with that, but facts.
I was watching a story on Baller Alert of a man who killed his wife and then like ate her. And it's like, he looked like a Haitian. So my first thought was, no. So I'm reading the story and I'm like, please don't be black. Then I saw his face and I was like, all right. You're black. Please don't be Haitian. That's what I said to myself. And he was, but I was like, why the extra, not thinking, why the extra step? Yeah, right?
Right, yeah, right,
why? Why do you have to do that?
Because that after black, and if he's black, all right. If he's black and Haitian, then you can identify.
Yeah. And I really don't want to identify with this. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. It's two. That's a crazy crime to identify near.
I think because it makes us look at ourselves.
Yeah.
It makes us feel like, damn, like, the fuck?
My people are capable of some shit like
that? Yeah.
Nigga,
so,
am I?
Yeah, like, oh, that's where I come from?
Yo, we just got to be real about the conversation, man.
That was voodoo, by the way, bro.
No, no, definitely. There's no doubt in my mind.
Oh, God, come on, guys.
No doubt in my mind. Okay? I've never woke up with an appetite for person ever. Yeah. It has to be voodoo. Come on, bro. Never, bro.
Why do Haitians do that, man? What do you mean? Y'all eat griot, the greasiest food in the world. It should be good. Greasiest food in the world. Somebody dropped dead of a heart attack. It was voodoo. Like, the person ain't been eating good their whole life.
Because I've watched niggas eat griot and live eternally. That's why. That's why, bro.
That's no, anytime something bad happens, the Haitians ain't voodoo.
Yeah, man.
My grandmother has probably eaten poverty meals for half of her life.
Okay. You know why? Because the Haitians
fried bark.
Haitians walk. They walk everywhere.
That's true.
Niggas get a everywhere. Divorce. Niggas get a divorce and die after grio for like 50 years.
But the divorce killed them.
Come on, man. Some shit just is. Like, I remember one time we had a homeboy that we went to school with, and he lost his mind. And it's like, man, somebody put voodoo on him. And I was like, but what about the cracker next to him? What about somebody put voodoo on the cracker too? Like, he crazy too. Like, I don't know, man. It's like we be scared of our own selves sometimes, man.
That's true. They put voodoo on everything.
Everything. If voodoo really worked, like Larry Dog said,
voodoo up some money, voodoo up some water, voodoo up a fucking house. That shit's still so funny to me, bro. If voodoo work, voodoo up some money, bitch.
Yeah, that's true. That's true as fuck. That was funny.
All right, guys, we have now reached the Ask a Real Nigga section of our program. This is where we get the chance to ask real niggas. In the meantime, I do want to send a shout out to my brother Jude at Cock Your Glock. I got to meet that nigga tomorrow, actually, pulling up to his office. Y'all boys get your shit together, okay? Especially you living in a goddamn country.
Mm-hmm. All right. Man.
Go to Cock Your Glock on IG. Jude can be reached at 786-315-3546, 786-315-3546. There you can get gun safety, gun license, learn how to load, cock, shoot, and all kinds of things with your gun. Fuck with Jude, Cock Your Glock for gun safety.
Bang.
Hey, 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 but you better ask a real nigga. Amazing. But you better ride with your boy, ride with your boy, ride. Ride with your boy, ride with your boy, slide. Ask a real nigga. You want a real nigga? Ask a real nigga. Black as fuck, boy. Like a gun trigger. Nigga, nigga. Follow me on Twitter. Nigga, nigga. Bitch, you big, I'm bigger. Nigga, nigga. I know I'm quick to hit her, nigga, nigga, and I'm about to hit her, spliffer, with my nigga, Chrissa.
Nah, we gonna chill out.
Goddamn, six rings. You're right, rings. Right. Y'all got me dancing to niggas. I'm sitting here bobbing like, that's six rings, man, that's six rings.
Oh, shit. Okay, so this first question comes from JM_ballislife2. Doctor and a basketball player. Go ahead, babe. She says, I woke up this morning wondering, how do men gain self-esteem and confidence, even from a young age? Like, how did y'all do it? Because it's not really pushed and promoted like it is with young women. Valinda thought that it was a great question for Ask a Real Nigga. So I want to ask you guys, like, what's brought you confidence in your youth? Or what did you use to, like, become the confident man that you are today, if you are confident? Chris said, fake it. And let me tell you something.
That's a real thing.
Any nigga in the sixth grade who wasn't faking and lying about who he was,
yeah.
I don't know. You must be different.
Sixth I'm grade, not saying grade. Lie about who you are.
I mean, but you know what I mean, but faking it is the lie.
Faking the confidence.
That's a lie. That's what that is. That's
a lie.
But it's what's not the real. Opposite? What's lying. The opposite?
Unconfident, loser, awkward. that's the truth.
But that's not who you are.
That's who I was.
You're a guy who takes chances.
I don't know. I faked that guy.
That's what I'm saying.
That guy's a lie.
That's a chance.
The guy taking chances is a lie.
That was a chance.
No. I was pretending to be a guy who took chances. I would never.
Yeah, I know we actually went to school together.
From fucking middle school.
From middle school. Plus was always the jokey guy.
But not too much, because my mother was really serious about that shit. My mother really did real life threats. I feared her, so I kept my jokey shit. Teacher said stop, I stopped. That's where my line was. I love jokes. Bitch say stop one time. All right, bet. You got it, boss. This nigga didn't give a fuck about the stops.
Nah, I give a fuck.
You see, this mild-mannered, respectable guy you have here, fucking Hellraiser. And then, fucking funny as fuck, freestyling all over the schools, bare-knuckling on the wall, rapping his ass off. This guy.
Yeah. Nah,
she get wicked.
But Ben, in your youth, how did you get your confidence up?
I really battled with myself about this. This is a hell of a question. But I want to say one of the moments that actually gave me confidence and like after this experience that I had, it made me not give a fuck what anybody thought or said when I beat up my bully. I beat his ass.
That'll fucking do it.
I finally cracked and I exploded, bro. I beat that motherfucker ass. And then ever since then, I was like, I don't give a shit what none of y'all say because you're going to have to fight me.
Did what you age let out?
You really got a problem with it.
Did you let out like an audible scream when you attacked him?
White man moment.
Probably whispering to that
my fucking 401k.
How old were you?
I had to have been, I think this was like maybe third grade. I was like second, third grade.
Bro.
Yeah, and the sweetest part is that I beat his ass in front of my mom.
Wow.
She was picking me up from school, and I beat his ass right next to the driver, the passenger side door.
Wait one second, there. Mommy. Three-piece.
No, mom's a gangster. She said, you're not leaving until you beat his ass.
Of course. Like, I don't remember really feeling confident until, like, in the sixth grade at the fucking school, they had, like, a broadcasting class where you could, like, do the news and all that shit on the little camera upstairs. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And shit is like, it was my first time like really feeling good at that shit.
Morning announcements.
Yeah, like, I was on the camera. I was funny. The class was laughing. And it was like, I felt good at some shit. So it's like, I took broadcast. I love that fucking class, but like being good at something gave me confidence. Niggas, till this day, nigga, I feel the best and the most confidence when I'm working and kicking ass.
That makes sense.
Ricky, how about you? How did you find confidence in your youth?
It was always like with people. I've always been good with people, and people just generally like gravitate towards me. So I'm always at my best when I'm around people.
So then have you ever suffered from a lack of confidence, rather?
Never really.
Why?
Not that I can remember.
Why?
Have you seen this guy?
No, because this is the thing, right? Like, I feel like it's your family, but I want you to say it because you're surrounded by cocky assholes.
Yeah,
from top to bottom, everybody.
It's my family.
Shout out Molly.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I gotta call her by
top to bottom.
Yeah, like it's just. I think it is my family because we're all alike. You know, just my parents always instilled that as you know, never just have no fear.
Yeah, because all of you like. Both, all three of your siblings, your cousins that I've met, what you say about your parents, you guys are all confident. Like
I've never, like you talk about in school, like I was always a class clown and I was always the person who would be first to, anybody want to speak or read in front of the class? I'll do it.
You see? That's amazing. Like, that's amazing.
Yeah, I've always been that person.
Because everybody ain't got that shit.
Yeah. I've never had to be pep talked to do something.
You like, see? They'll tell
that's
you. That's
what I mean. I'll jump on, you know.
Always on go.
Yeah, he was on go with. All the
That's
time.
That's amazing.
Yeah. All the time.
I never really struggled with like confidence thing.
Because
probably what I struggled with most was, the one thing I did struggle with most was the Haitian thing. I just never understood that shit, bro.
Like, because confidence can change your life's directory.
Like the Black Americans, like with Haitians.
Okay.
And you know what, too? Like, I didn't get it as bad as some Haitians only because, I guess, because I was so confident.
Confident, right.
You know what I'm saying? But I just, growing up in school, I never understood it. Like, I always seen it to this day. Like, you're Black, I'm Black. Like,
yeah. Oh, man. When I was going to school, we had whole fucking wars, bro.
Yeah.
Like, my whole... No, I'm serious. Like, war shit. Like,
hey, the first time Hassan came in here, right, he brought a nigga with him that was lurking in the back.
Yeah,
hood legend. Yeah. Okay. I once seen this nigga in third lunch. Okay. It was the Yank versus Zoe jump.
Right.
This nigga came out of his shirt, bro, and was literally like, niggas was fighting, right? And then all I hear is, oh shit, here come name redacted. Okay. He came through and was just, you know how he was like skipping through the crowd and like punching niggas as he was going through, and niggas were losing control of their knees.
Knocking niggas' heads off.
Roo, roo, roo. And then these same niggas pulled up on some bitches bitches got shirts out of their book bag, gave these boys different colored tall tees. These boys posted up. Security ran past us and didn't know these were the, these niggas, this is like Italian mafia shit.
Militants.
In high school.
Yeah, it was bad for us in school, bro. Bro. Yeah, real bad. I even started telling people, like, take your fucking socks and put rocks in it, bro. Because they had us outnumbered at the school. And they would literally come.
Who's going to school on 95th Street?
Yeah. Okay. The school was on 95th Street. Yeah. And so, yo, but it was fucking bad, bro. We would be out there starting riots at the school and all shit. We just want to go to school. We just want to go to Lego. You know what I'm saying? But I get what you're saying on that.
I just never understood this shit.
Shit was wild.
Yeah. That's insane, nah, it was wild out there.
Shit was crazy as fuck.
And now today, they like, they want to be your best friends. Like, it's like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's like.
That's the thing. Nothing ever happened. I don't think it's that bad now. It can't be that bad now.
No, it's not.
There's no way it's not that bad now.
No, it's not.
So, I mean, that's the thing. As long as evolution is happening, I don't mind taking my lumps for the children.
Right.
Okay,
right.
Because Lord knows what Zopan went in that era, whatever they were going through then. Because niggas were dying. Like, we got jumped.
Yeah.
But niggas were dying.
Yeah. That's why the gang Zopan actually started. Because to protect themselves from dying.
Black American.
Our brothers and sisters from the other side.
And that's the thing. It's not even their fault because we can't let white supremacy off the hook.
Cannot let white supremacy off the hook. No.
So it's like, because they feel these things or believe these things, poor things. Mm-hmm. And then you're young and then you frustrated.
Yeah.
All you want to do is be superior to somebody. I understand.
Yeah.
I get it. That's all it is.
Going back to the confidence part.
Yeah.
That little confidence. Chris, what about you, Chris?
Thank you, brother.
As far as
confidence.
Where did I get my confidence as a youth?
Yeah.
Oh man. If I had to say, man, I faked that shit, bro. Like I was a short kid all the way up until 11th grade. So I got picked on a lot for my height. I'm probably like 6'2" now. Yeah. But from like middle school all the way to 11th grade, I was like 5'5".
Damn.
Probably shorter than that for real, if we being real. But after I hit a growth spurt, you know what I'm saying? I started looking people in their eyes because mm-hmm. I felt confident, but nobody was hearing me out because they was like, nigga, you ain't tall enough to have all this confidence. Get the fuck out of here, nigga.
Such a little ass.
Like, little ass nigga, go sit down, man. Mm-hmm. And then, you know what I'm saying? Now I came back and I was looking niggas in their eyes like, yeah, I'm not sitting down no more, dog. I'm here now. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure a lot of people fake confidence.
Yeah, I mean, some people get it through sports. Some people get it through stores. Some people get it from their neighborhood.
I wasn't that good at sports.
Mm. Boy, me neither. Niggas were taking me for shit.
I was eh at everything.
Nigga, I'm paranoid, you know.
Like, it was you know, you got them kids that's great, like, for whatever reason. Like, they child prodigies for whatever reason. They was born with a basketball or football or whatever it was. Mm. I wasn't like that.
All right.
I don't know. So I would say my early boast of confidence came from how well I can speak to women. Like how well I can deal with a woman.
But see, that's the thing. You don't even get to talking to women without some confidence.
So yeah and no. How to build up. Yeah and no. Yeah, you got to build it up. Right, so my confidence came from how well I don't want to say manipulate, but how well I can I guess you can say, you know, I ain't proud of it.
It's a sales pitch.
But deal with a woman.
How well you can make yourself look. Hey, come on now. It's a sales pitch. Yeah.
Right. Because I mean, let's be real. A lot of our confidence comes from that. A lot of things that we actually do is to impress women.
Yeah.
And the same, and vice versa for them. So you build confidence off of that. Oh, she liked me. She digging me. Right. The acceptance aspect of it. So. Yeah, that's why I was a bit. And at an early age, you know, I had to beg my mom for some Jordans. But I got a pair of Jordans one year.
Boy.
And I felt like I was the shit, you know? And that gave me confidence to talk to girls.
And that's the thing. My confidence definitely could not come from clothes as a youth.
Yeah.
Okay? That wasn't one place I wasn't going to get it there.
No, not with Haitian parents.
Not with Haitian parents.
Not with Haitian parents.
I remember it being smart, but being smart wasn't cool back then it is now.
No. Like now, I don't even think it is cool now.
It's true, but like no one's saying, "Hey, you fucking nerd!" Like that's done.
Yeah, yeah,
no one's beating up niggas because you're smart. Hey, you dweeb, that's dead. Like smart niggas are just smart niggas.
Yeah.
But like back then, it was like niggas tried to. Remember when Will Smith hit his books in the pizza box? Like that's the kind of culture. Ah, that nigga reading a book.
You see, by the way, you seen the new Fresh Prince that's coming out? Like how they remade it?
I saw it. I'm interested.
It looks very
interesting.
Yeah. Only because they're repurposed. It's not a comedy. It's like
not a comedy. It's like a drama, yeah. Like the real backstory with everything. Like with like Uncle Phil when he was in college and with the what really happened at that fight ultimately led Will Smith to coming up to from Philadelphia. The black aspect of them living in Beverly Hills or West Bel Air, wherever the fuck.
I want to see how they reenact.
They made Whitney. They made what's the sister black?
She's it's gonna be a gay scene, dog. It's gonna be something gay in there. I promise you.
There's no way they're gonna leave it out.
That's why I can't relate to these new reboots. And it's gonna be something gay in there, man.
Yeah.
All right. So for sure. Let me ask you a question, right? Just because we're here now, why? Why not? Why not gay shit?
Because that's a European thing.
Well,
it's not, bro.
There is, historically speaking, there is no evidence of any homosexual activity being practiced on a wild scale in any African community prior to colonization by the Europeans or invasion by the Arabs.
Absence of evidence does not mean that it doesn't exist.
Okay. Well, absence of language. So you take language.
Okay. So there's no word for gay.
There's no word for gay. And if you take out the word, then there's no action for it because you need the word to define it.
Niggas calling that shit
You do
Niggas calling that shit ooh. No, that's a great point. If there's no word, then you can't define it.
Yeah, like even when we talk about like rape, there's no word for rape in any indigenous African language. When you say rape, they mostly say it in French or in like the European languages. There's no word for molestation. There's no word for old folks home. Like these words don't exist in our dialect because they did not exist in our mindset. That's now, a fact.
The fucking devil advocate in me wants to say that could be just because niggas don't think that rape is rape.
Maybe it's commonplace.
You understand what I'm saying? Like, it could be so common. Like, niggas don't know the difference between sex and rape. Because we're still having to teach niggas
I'm not laughing at rape.
In a quote-unquote progressive society, niggas are still learning the difference here.
Mm.
That's true.
You know what, though?
It's it?
Yeah.
We'll take that.
What the fuck was I talking about? This is what I was talking about here. This girl tweeted this shit, and the internet ate her alive. And I want to know, is it weird, or do you understand what she means? She says, I just seen this meme that says, I want to be my man's daughter. And I felt that in my soul. And they were like, what the fuck do you mean, you creepy bitch? I want to be
this man's daughter?
And her follow-up tweet was pretty much, she was saying how men love and nurture and protect their daughters, and I just want somebody to love me like that.
Jesus Christ.
I know.
What?
I'll read the tweet again.
Man.
I'll read it one more time. It says here, I just saw a meme that says, I want to be my man's daughter, and I felt that in my soul.
She black?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Brothers, please father your children. Come back from the fucking store.
Man, it is, black ain't black no more. Black is not black no more. There's so many variations of black. There's gay black. There's fucking transgender black. Like, transgender black, but yeah, black ain't black no more. Like, it's certain things that when I grew up as a child, specifically, and we're gonna narrow it down to the Haitian community, where you would say, I don't know no gay Haitian. I don't know. I grew up and I did not know any gay Haitians.
Yeah.
This day and age, you could throw a rock and hit a gay Haitian. And I'm not trying to be disparaging, but that's just what, like, certain things are not culturally
a Gaitian.
Certain things are like culturally norm. Like even Chris, I'm sure in Jamaica, you know, that's big frowned upon.
Yeah, yeah.
So
probably not anymore, but I don't know about now.
Yeah. Nah, they forcing people into that shit now. Like Haiti just had their first gay parade.
In Haiti?
Very good. Yes, man.
Oh shit.
Yes. Forced and funded by the United States, by the way. There's actually a movement. There's actually a movement. Check this shit out. So you're saying why, right? There's actually a movement. I want y'all to look this shit up. Called the Underground Railroad. And what it does is it specifically goes into African countries and Caribbean countries and brings gay people from those countries to the United States. It's called the Underground Railroad.
Because it's also called trafficking, right?
Like, a few years ago, when Haiti legalized gay marriage, I was like, what the fuck? But it's old school French Revolution shit. I'm not going to trade and work with a country that's mean or oppressive to gay people. So if you want aid, if you want help, you got to play ball.
Yeah. Yeah, they just like strong army.
If you want to be recognized as a motherfucking country,
they strong army.
Pay up this billion. You got to play ball. It's one of those things. Mm-hmm. Like they manipulate the fact that you might need them eventually.
Yeah, they strong army. White supremacy.
Facts. I'll never let white supremacy off the hook.
Never let the motherfuckers off the hook.
Hey, Ricky, I'm sorry. Just to piggyback off of you, we have to throw ggas in there too.
What is that? I'm lost. Yeah, I got a
Jamaican Jamaican.
I just got it. Jamaican. All right. Speaking of off the hook, we are recording live from the Vegetarian Delight Juice Bar. Pull up on the 6060 Miramar Parkway, Miramar, Florida, for some of the most bussin' food you will find this side of the Mississippi. I know you've seen my dog on TikTok. Pull up and stop playing. Vegan Trap Lord Delight Juice Bar on the Instagram. Brand new menu every day. 954. Give me the first one.
No, you get paid for this.
954-274-7402.
Fuck, what? 954-241-7402.
241-7402. 241-7402.
I'm deducting this much payment.
I just call. Pull up. Honest, I had me a bussin' ass cheeseburger today.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I'm sending the cash out request.
Appreciate you, black man. When
COVID was beating my ass, I came here and got bottles of healed. Okay. I'm taking Robitussin, all that other bullshit. Nothing is working. Chris healed me in 48 hours. It's just crazy.
It's gangster shit.
Yeah, man. Yeah, yeah. Health is culture,
man.
Yo, speaking of off the topic. Please. What y'all think about
another? Again, health is culture. You see that shit?
Yeah, health is culture.
All right. You right now? You see the vibe?
Got his ass. Yeah. Got his ass.
I'm not gonna take that from him. He's been waiting on it.
Wait on you for months.
Yo, how do y'all feel about other podcasts like Fresh and Fit? Another example.
You know what?
Going back to Caribbian people. One of the dudes from Africa, one dude's from the Caribbean. Right? So going back to
and
that.
So like when the FBA be talking, they're talking about niggas like those.
Right.
Because those are like those guys would be a terrible representation of black men.
Right. But like, they are. At a podcast.
But in that moment, they were the ones, quote unquote, representing us.
Stop it at terrible representation.
Yeah. Period. But at that moment, they were the ones representing us.
Man,
so I'm more than happy to say, hey, man, I'm not Trinidadian or whatever the fuck that nigga is. I don't know what them boys on.
Yeah.
You understand? I don't know what these niggas are on.
I'm not a gook, so I don't know what the fuck them niggas on.
I'm not a fucking dweeb. I don't know what them niggas on.
Can't fucking relate to that shit.
Fucking spaz.
That shit's terrible, man. That's what happens, man. Like, when you let goofies And to give them a mic, put a mic in front of their face, and put a fucking camera in front of their face, they start doing shit like that.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? And we keep saying, don't let white people or white supremacy off the hook. Don't let these goofy ass niggas off the hook, man.
Now I will say this in the spirit of being fair:
these goofy ass niggas being a product of white supremacy.
Have I come on this podcast and said some crazy wild shit that if the world saw, nobody would like me either? Sure. Yeah. Tons of it. Right? But I'd like to think that I'm better than some of it. Not all of it. I still believe some of that shit. I don't believe everything that I've said on this podcast anymore. Mm. Right? Yeah. Like hearing it back,
give thanks for growth.
Listening to myself has helped me grow exponentially. So I'm hoping there's room for the fuck niggas to do it too.
Nah.
I know. Because people gave me grace when I was out here tripping. Right. I got grace. Right. I know I got grace. I know I was here.
Those trannies didn't give us grace.
Giving out gratuitous bitches.
The trannies didn't give us grace.
Don't say tranny, man. Come on. Yes. Come on, Blackie.
What? Yes. What the fuck do we call them?
Blackie. You want to be called Blackie?
No. I'm black.
Well, are you not a tranny?
If I'm transgender, then what do you call
them?
Come on, bro.
No, but what do I fucking call them?
We were doing great.
Can't do this.
We had a great episode. We were doing great.
No, this topic pisses me off, bro.
I mean, if they suck dick, aren't they dick suckers?
All right, Chris, final thought.
If you love food, let me out of here.
Let me out of here.
Food, are you not a foodie?
Let me out of here. Chris, final thoughts. Take us home.
Jesus Christ. Okay? It's a fucking...
We had a great episode. It's woman friendly. I want to keep it that way.
But
fucking wrap it up.
Trannies aren't women.
Chris, final thoughts.
Come on, bro.
Trannies aren't women, man. They don't have to. They,
but why can't I say that? If you're a transgender.
I'm happy you said they, honestly. That's really great.
You know, I give them their.
That's really great. You
what
know?
They call it? I give them their little pronoun. That's how that.
Yo, I saw a fucking TikTok video, bro. Whatever. He pulled up on a girl and she was like, I identify as they. She's like, what you mean? So you they? So it's like, so y'all gonna let me fuck?
No. On a serious tip, I think transsexuals need to be charged with rape if they out here fucking with dudes and not exposing the fact that they transsexuals.
That's I'm gonna rape. Keep it a buck with you, right?
That's rape.
I agree with you, but I also don't think that happens as much as niggas willingly fucking boys and then acting surprised when they get caught. That's what I think happens more than them getting bamboozled, if I had to tell you the truth.
Yeah, I agree with that.
If you trick me, you deserve death. Sure. Yes. But yes. I don't believe these boys are not seeing the Adam's apple. Come on. I don't buy it.
Come on.
I think they see it.
I watched.
You
listen,
never went on TikTok. I
watched Euphoria, and the first 10 seconds, I knew that was a fucking man.
Come on.
I knew that was a fucking
Come
man.
Come on, baby.
I was Chris, like, that's a man.
Chris, we going to stay on all blackness, Chris. You never went on TikTok and be like, damn, that was a good transformation. No homo.
Those surgeries cost $75,000 to look that good. Yeah. Your average trans person looks like Juana, man. I know you, cuz. Yeah. You never going to bamboozle me.
Looks like me in a
My
week.
Record is impeccable. Bamboozle
the
free.
Saying
bro, you're 6'5", 240.
The niggas saying chiseled. They're tricked aren't getting tricked by those.
That's what I'm saying. My nigga.
Okay.
By well, them. All right. By them. Put by some, them.
Some, niggas not getting tricked, bro. I believe niggas are lying.
Nah, facts.
Niggas, bro.
You think that?
Come on. Because at this point, I feel like trans people know it's a death sentence. And so many of them die a year because of shit like this. I would hope that no one's out here willingly playing that game. But I know niggas lie.
Nah.
Okay, I know niggas lie.
I know niggas are into that shit because anytime I'm looking at porn, there's always like, you know, the categories. There's a whole shemale thing.
There's a ladyboy section.
It wouldn't be there if
there's like four of them. There's ladyboy BBW.
Yeah, there's not just four. It's thousands of videos in that shit,
and
bro.
The category wouldn't exist.
If it wasn't a thing.
Okay. Yeah. Tourism in Thailand wouldn't be so lit if niggas wasn't on this shit.
Every time you see a celebrity get caught with a trans, they want to act surprised. Yeah, right, Bobby Valentino.
I'm starting to learn that I can't judge the world by my morals. And I used to. Which is why I would think nobody could ever do that. Right. It's impossible. It doesn't exist. But my friend, the world wasn't raised in your household. Mm. The world wasn't raised by your parents. The world don't have your morals and values. Sometimes these niggas want to fuck boys and not tell nobody.
Yo, one of my favorite artists, Teddy Pendergrass. That shit broke my heart.
I know.
Y'all know the story about Teddy Pendergrass?
I don't want to hear it. Come on.
Okay, we'll leave it at that.
He was with dating a man, and the wife got mad, or the girlfriend got mad and did something to the car, right?
Well, the police did something to the car, but he ended up getting in a car accident, getting paralyzed with a tranny in the car. Like, that's a fucking hell of a way to get caught.
Because that's what I'm saying. What, you think he ain't know who he was in the car with? Wasn't even no surgery back then. All you had is makeup and a tuck.
Come on. I'm going to give my man Teddy Duke. I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt, man.
With no surgery.
I just can't. As a man, as an African, I can't. What is that, yo?
I'm so sorry, bro.
I ain't disrespecting nobody. Do what you do, but do it over there.
Apparently I'm disrespecting by calling him a tranny, which is the name.
Nah, bro.
Yeah, they're a tranny. They're a tranny.
Is that word? Is that worse defensive?
Okay, here's where I've moved, right, as far as like my understanding of this kind of shit. I tell crackers, don't call me nigga, right? Okay. I don't need a discussion. I'm not going to tell you why. I say, don't call me nigga. You call me nigga, I fire off. I want that respect, so I'm going to give it. If you say, don't call you tranny, what's your name, cuz? Trans? Right. Bet. You trans from now on. Because if you, as a trans person, call me nigga, it's time for the fade. Because I asked you not to. So respect me, and I respect you.
But see, here's the thing. We got to deal in reality. I'm not going to call you something that I know that you're not. Like, when does it stop? Because when does it stop? Now, one of these Europeans, they'll start saying, well, I was born 36, but I'm really a baby, so treat me like a baby. Look, and then start on some weirdo shit.
If your stance is that you're not going to refer to a trans person as a woman, I don't think I knocked that stance.
Okay.
I don't knock that stance because okay. I know what a woman is. I was raised with it, right? But still, like, I'm the type of nigga when I'm around trans people because there's some in the comedy game. I try to use non-gendered words. My nigga, cuz, fool, motherfucker, those. That's how I get off.
I just didn't think tranny was a defensive term.
And you won't stop is a problem.
All right. No, I'm not trying to be defensive, but.
All right, so transgender?
Transgender.
Transgender.
They, transgender, they, just they, trans.
I just don't want to play the whole mind fuck game, man.
Because I'm not, because I hear what you're saying, right? Like, and this thing is, right, if they were just women, then we wouldn't have to say trans women.
Right.
Like, we have to say trans in the front because it's not the same. There's something different. There's an asterisk.
I mean, and,
but I still want to respect whatever the motherfucker believes they are.
Yeah, go ahead, bro.
Yeah, I mean,
let me, the same way I believe penis whatever the fucking vagina. Foundation of Black Americans believe that they are.
Respect is due.
I guess it's all about buying in.
It's not even about buying in. It's just I know how I want to be treated and respected and listened to. And to get, you got to give. Pause.
Yeah, you got to buy into it. Because yeah, they don't have man, to give
Black
you,
people have been giving
you could,
for years.
You could give and shit. Not get shit.
Very like, true.
Black people.
That's very true.
It's been that way very for true. Quite more. It's been that way more often than it's not been that way. So I would say that. I don't all right, know.
So I'll stop saying the word so then.
That's taking a chance regardless.
The way that I look at it, for somebody to go to such a length to live a particular lifestyle, I'm like, okay, all right, this motherfucker really serious about this shit. So I'm not going to play around about what you serious about. So fuck it.
No, there's been studies, though, who people had the surgery and they regret having the surgery, right? So I don't know. Well, how far do you really take that?
I don't have any hate for them. I don't speak bad about them. I just wanted to know why is the term so offensive if it's in the word. It's like that's all I was trying to figure out.
They consider it a slur, and I also have people. I have an issue with people like okay, highlighting nigger, words that I always exist as slurs.
Mm-hmm. Right, nigger with the ER is a slur. Right, a white person can't come up to you and say, "Hey, niggy."
Hey, niggy is funny, but I don't like it. What's good, my niggy? It's adorable.
I mean, I respect anyway. That. I'm not saying that. Nigger, I'm not buying into it. I'm not buying into it.
But niggy is still not. It's that's still crossing the line. It's the same thing.
Yeah, I'm not buying into it. Because even when you look at some of the laws, and I'm not just saying this is all their particular group, but when you look at some of the laws, right, like these whole bathroom sharing things, right, yeah. And you look at some of the cases that came out of that where these people or them that's or a particular right. group,
you're nailing it.
In the bathroom. Right? They putting up cameras. They trying to touch kids. They did. It's just a whole bunch of shit that go into it, man. Yeah, I'm not trying to say that's the whole group, but when you look at some of these bathroom cases and situations, it's usually coming from that particular demographic. Not saying that they're all pedophiles or whatever, but yeah, I mean, I don't think that is natural. I don't think it's a state of being natural.
I can't let you off the hook, Hassan. Earlier you said transgender. I immediately thought of like a transgender McConnor McGregor.
McGregor. Transgender.
Yeah.
Facts, man. Listen, black folk don't owe nobody nothing but ass whooping. John Henry Clark. Keep that quote in your mind. Black folk don't owe nothing to nobody but an ass whooping. Any other group. That includes the LGBT community who's rode the back of Black Americans or Foundation of Black Americans who paid the rate for the civil rights, and then they try to compare their struggle to the Black American struggle.
Sick.
So, you know, sick. We always get infiltrated.
I literally just saw a video on TikTok today. Mind you, I'm learning more on TikTok than I did in high school. It's just wild. So apparently when MLK and a few others were putting together the civil rights bill for them to be, you know, all the shits, they wouldn't move unless that included Chinese Americans as well. And all immigrants, really. So it's like he wouldn't move forward because he had African Americans' rights sewed up and done.
Yeah.
And the nigga wouldn't move or wouldn't button until it was everybody. And only for Asian American immigrants to be fucking terrible sometimes. It's crazy. That's the thing. Like, this is the shit they be talking about because mm-hmm. foundational Black Americans, they let everybody in and don't always get that love back.
But they always say Black people, just in general, are just graceful people. Like,
right.
We don't have it in us to be these monsters that they make us out to be.
Hey, so I tweeted a picture of us right now. Niggas are saying, yay, Brother Hassan, but somebody has said the Patreon gang should have it first. So we have to have it do it first so they can hear the Hassan gospel first.
That makes sense.
Fair request.
Consider it done, RG.
It makes sense.
You getting this one fresh off the press,
fresh
my
off
dog.
The presses.
Probably not.
fucking your brother. Oh shit, the GOAT Hassan. Niggas excited, man. What the fuck?
Six rings, man. Niggas excited. Six rings, man.
Rick, final thoughts, baby.
Final thoughts, man. Not everybody can be as fucking amazing as me and have, you know, come out of the womb with confidence. Mm-hmm. But just, you know, try, man. Just big yourself up, man. That's what we meet people do in Jamaica. We big ourselves up, you know, like the big tunes we always listen to. So yeah, man, big yourself up, man, and praise King Selassie.
Ben, final thoughts.
God bless, nigga.
I've grown past the days of being a Haitian booty scratcher. Please don't call me a Haitian booty scratcher. I respect your position, FBA, ADOS. But some Haitians eat cat. Okay, not all of us. Some of them. But tell a friend to tell a friend about the podcast. I appreciate y'all listening and tuning in and, you know, continuing to be loyal. And, oh, Brother Hassan, thank you so much for gracing us with your presence, man. It's always a pleasure, dog.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Chris, final thoughts?
Shout out everybody that stayed locked in and stays locked in with us on all social media platforms everywhere. Shout out the gang. You know what it is.
Y'all boys, no matter how crazy you look, don't stop fighting for your children. Fuck how you look. It's what your kids are going to remember when they're older. Bennessy, did we have anything you keep for Song of the Week?
We did not.
All right, get my final thoughts.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Shit. Damn, I'm sorry. Man. My bad, brother. Yeah. Shit, good. Give me time.
I want to definitely send a love and shout out to my African-American Foundation of American brothers out there. We understand the plight. We're understanding the plight. Ben. You were saying the thing about Haitian booty scratcher. We can't pretend that we haven't used words like yank in our culture as well to describe our brothers and sisters. So we want to apologize for that. Have that out there, right?
All those words.
But overall, I want to say this. I want to leave with a quote by Dr. Amos Wilson, who somebody who inspired me said, Dr. Amos Wilson. He said, "I'm an African. The death of my brother is also my death." So when we divide ourselves as a group, it ultimately ends to our death and our destruction as a people. So although we have our different ethnic groups, I wish that we come together as a unified force.
Facts.
That's beautiful. And I think that's the best note to end this pod on. Brother Hassan is always my brother. It is a pleasure. I'm happy we was able to get this done finally. Hey. We've been trying to get it done for 3 months. But we got this one in.
Yes, sir.
This is a good damn time. Man, Ben, I'll beatbox if you want to fuck that shit. Oh, I see what you're doing. Change it up.
BrotherHassan.com. Get your merch. Get your buttons. Get your books, your shirt. Head over there, BrotherHassan.com.
You guys heard it first. I'm doing a 10-city tour in May. Mm. Ugh. Locked in 6 already. Announcing in a month.
Nice, man. Congrats.
I'm not allowed to talk about it, but... But you do, I realize the fucking fans stay separate. My NWO fan, the Haitian comedy fans, there's only a sliver that's both.
I'm sorry. I know I'm supposed to play the music right now. I meant to reach out to the brother Haitian. Did he get offended when I did the video in Little Haiti? Haitian brother that when we were school with him, he be wearing the Haitian grandma.
Success.
Yes.
You did a video?
I did a video.
Let me see, bro. Let me see.
I don't know if you see it, but shout out to him. No disrespect to the brother, man. No disrespect to the brother. Shout out to the brother, Success.
That's beautiful.
Shout out, Success.
All right. Benny Boy, what song of the week?
Song of the week is a cutoff of Gunna's album.
And as always, thanks for listening to the NWO podcast. Peace.
No, but how did you do that?
And as always, thanks for listening to the NWO podcast. Peace.
That was a goodie, gentlemen.
I appreciate y'all for bringing
me. Good. No, nigga, you were needed here today. Right. We couldn't have this episode without you. Mm-hmm. Cause I've been dying to talk about the ADOS, nigga. It just so happened that I learned about the FBA shit recently. Mm-hmm. And it was perfect.
Chris, how much are we for this?
Nah, man. It's on NWO.
Bro,
so
how much we owe you for this?
Pushing six three. Rings, man.
Yeah, man.
Six rings.
Six, golly.
What's the rest of me? Y'all picked out what y'all want?
Yeah, I'm gonna
go. Oh, yeah.
Let me,
I kind of splurged up the crew. Yeah,
man. Looks like you splurged. The European has mobilized in the sanity.
Yeah, that's the gentleman I didn't pull from, Dr. Amos Wilson.
I took that one.
They normalized that shit.
That's sad with me, man.
What a restroom, man. Go
right to the back. Like right where you came in at, the other door.
Oh, yeah. One's man terrorist is another man's freedom.
You recycle
these? That's another one.
No.
Damn, man. What's up, buddy?
Oh, man.
Let me see if you're gonna go where I went for my third one.
So now,